right, good morning. Welcome to everyone and come to order. This is the February 5th, 2018 meeting of Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I'm the chair, Amy Gailey, and we are all present this morning. Before we begin, we're going to have a moment of silence to remember Linda Massey, who passed away within the past few weeks. She was Alamance County Commissioner and former chair. I would ask, Mr. Lashley is going to do our invocation, so if we would take a moment to remember Mrs. Massey, and then Mr. Lashley, when he feels it's appropriate, start with the invocation.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause this time to honor you. We thank you for the blessings that you share with us each day. We thank you most for loving us, and we thank you for loving our nation. We ask you to continue to bless us, bless this day, and help us as county commissioners to do the things that please the voters and the taxpayers of Alamance County. These things we pray in your holy name. Amen.
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 I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right. Next on the agenda is public speakers. I'm going to take a moment. I started reviewing our public comment policy and the audience to forum rules that have been adopted by the county commissioners, just to emphasize that we're not doing this in response to anything that's happened or anything we expect to happen. This is just something to do to review the rules so people know what's expected and when they come, know how things go. One thing I want to emphasize is that if anyone does want to come and make a present or give a public comment, if you bring a copy of your comments, you can leave them with the clerk to the board and she will include them in the minutes. And so if you run out of time in the public comment period, then that's really a great option available to you. So the comment period is limited to 30 minutes. Then we'll have a commissioner's response period immediately following. That's a point of response for commissioners to respond to comments that have been made, not to debate with the public. Each person desiring to speak during the public comment period has 3 minutes. There will be no more than 3 speakers on any one topic per meeting. It's recommended that speakers desiring to speak on the same topic and advocating the same position choose one person to speak for all. Speakers shall address the board from the lectern at the front of the room and begin their remarks by stating their name and address. If anyone has a disability that needs accommodation, you just let us know. We'll be more than happy to accommodate that. Public comment is not intended to require the Board of Commissioners to answer any impromptu questions. Speakers shall address all comments to the commissioners as a whole and not to individual commissioners. Discussions between speakers and members of the audience are not allowed. Speakers shall be courteous in their language and presentation. Speakers shall not discuss any of the following matters which concern the candidacy of any person seeking public office, including the candidacy of the person addressing the county, matters which are the subject of public hearings, and matters which are closed session matters, including but not limited to matters within the attorney-client privilege, anticipated or pending litigation, personnel, property acquisition, and matters which are made confidential by law. That public comment policy was revised September 2014 and is available online. The decorum of the audience. Audience members shall refrain from making unsolicited comments during the meeting. During speakers from the floor debate by the board, audience shall refrain from conduct which disrupts the proceeding. This conduct may include but is not limited to cheers, hissing, booing, clapping, cursing, or any other conduct which disturbs the proceedings. Audience members, please silence all cell phones and other electronic devices while attending the meeting. With those being reviewed, we have one person signed up for public comment. That's Mr. Henry Vines. I don't see Henry.
Hey, Henry.
I'm sorry. Listen, Henry, did you want me to ask real quick, if it's about the subject of the public hearing, then you can wait to make your comments when we get to the public hearing part. Is that right? Okay. Well, great. Is there anybody else who wanted to make a public comment Henry's going to wait until we get to the part about behind the power.
Could I make one comment?
Of course. Okay.
Dean, you had your name down there.
Yeah, I got my name down there. Commissioner, I'd just like to ask y'all if y'all would consider having these meetings for public hearings and stuff in the afternoon. People like myself at work, I find they isn't, but I can. It does inconvenience the average working person to most people work during the day, or second shift, you know, and some third. But I'd appreciate your consideration on that, on these public comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, do we have any commissioner responses? If not, then let's move on to approval of the agenda. I hope that everyone has had a chance to review the agenda. Does anyone have any questions or comments or discussion? Do we have a motion?
No, no.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and second to approve the agenda. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. And consent agenda, is there anything that needs to be removed from the consent agenda?
Make the motion, we approve it as is.
Second.
Thank you, gentlemen. We have a motion and a second. And all those who approve the consent agenda, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, next is the public hearing about the Economic Development Incentive Grant for Honda Power Equipment. So first we'll have Mr. McWilliams to present the item.
Thank you, Madam Chairman and Mr. Commissioners. Delighted to be here this morning. I'm Matt Williams with the Chamber of Commerce. And 2 weeks ago came to you to ask for this hearing for Honda Power Equipment. That is considering an expansion in the intervening period. We have had working with the company and the county staff, working on the performance agreement. And I think we're ready to talk about that today too. So with me today are two representatives of the Honda Power Equipment Swepsonville facility. Robert Whitehead is the vice president, and Freddie Wynn is a quality leader and project manager for this project. So I'll ask them both to come up and speak. There are some slides, I think, that they want to use in their presentation. And I'll be happy to help them answer any questions after. So with that, I'll introduce Robert Whitehead.
Good morning, everybody.
Welcome.
I'd like to start off first by thanking everybody for their time today and considering our request. Also, I'd like to thank Mac Williams and his team for their efforts and also their fast response time. So Honda Power Equipment has been located in Alamance County now for over 30 years. We've had a lot of great successes and a lot of expansions. And we're poised now for a future expansion for initiative production. So what we're looking at is a couple of different phases. Phase one is a $10.5 million expansion to our facility of 116,000 square foot. With this phase one, this would allow us to be in the running for future production products at HPE instead of going overseas. So we're looking forward to working with the community and help support HPE in this initiative. Also, I'd like to turn it over to Freddie Wynn, one of our senior managers here. He's going to go over some about HPE and some about the expansion project.
Good morning, and thank you for allowing us to come today. On the slides over here, this is just a little bit about Honda Power Equipment. At our facility, maybe a lot of you don't know what we do there. We build what we call 5 horsepower, 5.5 horsepower engines. We build over 2 million of these a year. On our frame side, we're very proud of our lawnmowers. We've been building these lawnmowers since 1984. You can see we have our Best Buy units. We have our we're ranked number one for 12 years in a row with a Consumer Reports. And then we have our commercial units. So we're very proud of what we do with HPE. And Here are some more of our frame products. We build mini tillers, single-stage snow throwers, two-stage water pumps, string trimmers, and generators. So altogether, on our frame side products, we build over 500,000 a year. So moving into the phase, this is our HPE's campus, and I know it's hard to see here, but you can see the outline. This is the building we're talking about. This is our main assembly building, manufacturing building. This area here in black is the 116,000 square feet that we want to add. 100,000 of it is factory space, and then around 16,000 for office area. This just gives a better layout or a view. This is our factory building. This in the gray here is what we're wanting to add on for our addition. This just shows our emergency way coming around the building and back out to our parking lot. And this is just a isometric drawings of what our building will look like. If you've ever been by Honda Power Equipment, we will continue that same look down the front of the building. And then we'll have dock doors on the north side. So that's all I have at this time.
So with this expansion, this will allow us enough space in the future to position Alamance County on the Park Equipment facility to be ready to take on the next product that Honda Motor produces. So I'd like for you to consider and please approve our grant. Any questions at this time?
Yes, I have a question. Initially, the request was 45 million, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, we're down to 10 and a half, is that correct? Okay, why the change there, may I ask that?
It wasn't approved by Honda Motor for the total investment yet. So far, they've only approved the 10.5 for us to build the building. They're still studying which is the best facility to do the next product in, and we want to show them that we're ready and capable of doing it, which will lead to the next step, which would be the investment for all the equipment.
At that point, would you suspect that you have incentive requests at that time as well?
They're both included at this time, all in one package.
What today's vote would
occur then?
So if you come to us then for the addition, you won't have it. Well, you won't come to us. Okay. And how many jobs technically?
It won't be no jobs. What we're hoping is this will preserve the jobs that we have because of so many changes in the small engine power equipment regulations for the future from the EPA. We're trying to position ourselves so we're ready for the next product when EPA guidelines get too strict for the current engine.
And this isn't meant to, it's just for my information, please. I respect you, I'm glad you're here, I voted for your first incentive, or not your first, but I voted for incentives for your company years ago. And I just have turned against doing incentives, nothing personal, I'm doing it with everybody. But can you tell me what percentage of employees that you have there that are temporary? And I think you have an associate relationship with the company that provides some labor, is that true? Can you tell me either with both of those, possibly separately, how many of those are temporary employees?
I think currently, as of the beginning of this month, it's about 40 to 45% of temporary employees.
Temporary. Now, is that total between the two entities, the mother plant and the associate?
Just a Honda Power Equipment.
Okay. Now, what about the, don't you have a separate labor producing agreement that temporary agencies fail to?
Only at our facility, we have like 777 full-time associates.
Right.
And I said, then we have about 40% temporary, which is about 500 temporary.
Associates. Okay. And that's at the main plant?
At the main plant. Now, oh, maybe you're referring to, we also lease a warehouse up here in Burlington to do our warehousing, but they're part of our associates.
And what percentage of those are temporary?
I don't know because it's all rolled up into one company total.
Okay. Thank you. Can
we ask questions?
Sure.
Okay. So I'm just a little bit unclear. The $10.5 million,
Is that just construction only, that's not the equipment?
It's just to do the facility.
So if this gets approved, you wouldn't build the building until your parent organization, the superior, say it's okay, they're going to do this manufacturing here?
If approved, if they can prepare to move forward with the construction starting as soon as next month and be done, completed by March of next year.
So did I understand to Commissioner Sutton's question, then you, the equipment, you'd be adding equipment to that facility?
Correct, and we have to go back and get that investment approved by the, our mother company.
So you wouldn't be asking us for help with that?
No. It's all included in this package.
What we've done, Commissioners, is we have, we're incentivizing the construction of the real property up to $10,500,000, and in the event Honda adds equipment into that space, we're incentivizing the equipment, if they do it, up to the same amount.
Okay.
So it's not sure if Honda's going to add that equipment, but if they do, we have capped that dollar amount as the same as the real property investment. And they're both included in this incentive proposal, yeah.
So is it, it's at a different percentage rate?
That's correct.
All right, well, it's time to open the public hearing. If I could have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All right, all in favor of opening the public hearing?
Aye.
All right, do we have anybody, let's go to this side of the room, anybody who wants to be heard about the incentives proposed for Honda Power Equipment? Mr. Moser?
I'm Sammy Moser. Good morning, Commissioners, Chairman Gailey, Chairperson Gailey. I live in Burlington, I'm out on Maple Avenue. Early, before I get to this, I'd like to thank all of our law enforcement agencies for the work they do in Alamance County and across our state. I had a personal incident happen about 2 weeks ago, unfortunately rear-ended on Interstate 85. And when the highway patrolman got there and the traffic, once it speeded back up to 70, 80 miles per hour, just thinking that our law enforcement faces these situations every day and the dangers they face. I just want to take a moment and thank all of our law enforcement, the EMS, medical team, firefighters in our county. They need all of our appreciation and support. Okay. And thankful that I'm here and my son's here. We didn't have any serious injuries, but we did really get seriously re-ended. I want to commend Honda Manufacturing Company and all of your employees that you employ in Alamance County and from other counties. You have great products, and we're proud of what you're doing and what our county employees have helped you become, how they've helped you become successful. However, I disagree with continuing to give incentives to a great company like Honda. I think it's wrong. Just want to read a couple of articles out of the paper I've cut out through the years. The low road on incentives. I find any transfer of tax revenue to wealthy corporations by for economic development to be an abuse and misuse of government's taxing power. Incentives unfair because they do not apply the law equally. We must head off corporate greed at the pass. Chambers should be more open regarding deals. How much longer can we woo industry and still pay the bills? Petition Congress to end business incentives. I think I've heard some of our commissioners express the same thoughts. Dell Food, you remember Ferrara Food received money just to relocate from High Point to Mebane. I guess their employees, the people that had to drive from High Point to Mebane. This article says, the deal for food company provides some indigestion. Madison Taylor says, everybody hates the idea of cash incentives dangling dangling carrot to lure business development. Everybody hates it. I think I've heard some of our commissioners actually say that possibly they hate incentives. The truth is, economic incentives rank way down the list in factors used by business in deciding where they locate or expand. Jesse White, a professor at UNC School of Government, also noted that companies are learning how to play one state against the other and counties the same way. He said, noting that some had labeled the corporate incentives bidding war as corporate bribery and extortion. Corporate bribery and extortion. And I'm going to say, I don't blame Mr. Whitehead and his associates for being here asking for incentives. I mean, right now, that's the name of the game. And I certainly don't blame him. It's just, but I think maybe we need to look at changing our economic incentive policies. We've got Commissioner Byrd, who was on the, I think it's the state commissioner board. Maybe we can go to some of our other county commissioners in other locations and let's start talking about, is it time to take a different approach to economic incentives? Mr. Craig Honeycutt, when he was our county manager, had this to say, some of the region's competitive administration advantages include, that's our advantages, include our interstate system, water and sewer capacities, low taxes, public schools, and universities. So I think he's implying we have a lot to offer all of our corporations to stay in, to be in Alamance County. At the economic workforce, John Metcalf of Workforce Systems said, he was a speaker at the chamber retreat, he said Alamance County has a lot of assets working for it. He mentioned the good logistics and the quality labor force in Alamance County. Now we could go on, but we don't need unfair incentives to boost economic growth in Alamance County. One of the last articles, I'm just about finished up, said that the way government gives incentives needs revision. And I'm not sure if I quite agree with this, but he says what we should do instead of saying we should say if you are still here after 12 years, this is a check we will give you for your success and loyalty. Now, I suggest we should give them a check, but if you're here after 10 or 12 more years, then we should consider what would be the proper way to handle the situation. And one reason we might want to consider that, I think we really do need, and I'd encourage our commissioners to look at our economic incentive policy, the existing policy. We've had some companies, and I'll just mention two or three, Honda Arrow, LabCorp, I think they received $1 million in 2009, and in 2013, I believe it's when they decided they unfortunately were going to move 960 employees out of Alamance County, pretty much leaving the city of Burlington just nearly a ghost town. So, but at that time, LabCorp, according to the paper report, was still in a position to receive $400,000 from Alamance County, even after they had moved out 960 employees. So I don't know if that's still in the works or not. So this may be another reason to take a closer look at our incentive policy. And again, I commend all of our workers and employees down at Honda Equipment. I think that obviously doing a great job, it's a great company. But just asking our commissioners, please take a closer look at what we're doing with our incentive policy. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Does anyone on the, our right side of the room wish to be heard about the economic incentive agreement for Honda Power Equipment? All right.
I thank you. Commissioner for the job team to speak. I stand for you today. I mean, I'm opposed to these incentives. I think that we've used the incentive program to, it's supposed to be an economic development. This is to be to create economics in our county, to create jobs. If I understood right, and I heard here, there's no jobs even associated with this economic incentive. That's what these incentives were established for back, I guess, in 2009. At that time, I was for that because we needed jobs. We needed economic development. Since that time, our economic development in this county has grown drastically and has grown by individuals and companies coming into this county on their own, investing millions and millions of dollars to do business in this county. Without asking for anything, not one single dime they have asked for. We've got big motels, we've got paint route, we've got, you know, just on and on. You know, no incentives asked for. And I can understand these corporations. I mean, I wish I was going to build something to me and I come here and ask for a little bit too. But I'm a small businessman, like a lot of other folks are in here. I don't get no help. When that tax bill comes, y'all want your money. And, you know, we're facing right now the possibility of going up 18 cents on our property taxes with this bond referendum that's going in now. More money for most of the citizens. Secondly, I'd just like to say that all these big corporations and everything have just got a huge incentive. Our president just dropped the corporate tax rate from 35% to 21%. That's going to mean millions for a company like this right here. I know a small businessman in this county that said it's going to save him $200,000 a year. So I know it's got to be in the millions for these people. That's what this whole deal was, the president said. It was to give the corporate, the industry, incentive to build, to expand, to give higher wages. So here we got them back down here asking for it, $262,000. I mean, why? I mean, this company's a multi-million-dollar company. You mean to tell me that they need $262,000 to survive? I just can't believe that. So I just don't believe it. I don't believe they're going to leave. And they've been here a long time. And I just wanted, I know, Commissioner Gather, you like to research.
Thank you.
And everything. And I just want to, if y'all don't know, don't remember this, I do. Back in 2009, when we had an economic drop, Honda let 200 full-time employees go. Now, I know some folks that work down there. They let the full-time people go and they kept the part-time people. Now, I don't know how many of these folks are back to work. It says in this article right here that there was 725 people employed and they lost 200. I don't know if all 200 back or not. And I'm going by this article. I don't have any physical evidence or anything like that. But commissioners, I think they've been here for 30-some years, and they're part of our community in order to respect and want to contribute to our community. This is to help them make more money. This is not to help Alamance County make more money. And I understand all things that's been said about return on investment. Commissioners, I'm standing here, I'm telling you right now, I think it's time that we do away with this incentive. Our economic development's going great. They're pushing the farms out the door. We got people wanting to come to this county without getting and asking for a dime. It's time, I know a lot of you up here are conservative and all, it's time to get back to letting the, you know, competition drive itself. And I appreciate your time, and I hope that y'all consider this and not give this incentive. I'd like to see Alamance County be a first in talking about giving incentive. We've been first bill for many things in this county. We're standing up for what's right and a lot of things. That thing God we trust right up there. This is the right thing to do. It's time to stop this. I hate to say this, but industrial, or what do you want to call it, welfare. Thank you, commissioners. I appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mr. Vine. Is there anybody else who wants to be heard in the public hearing regarding this particular incentive package?
Yes.
Mr. Bowden.
Yes. Madam Chairman, thank you very much. And like some of the preceding speakers, I do want to emphasize the quality and caliber of the Honda Power equipment presence here in Alamance County. By the way, to comply with the thing, I'm Tom Boning, Jr., publisher of the Alamance News here in Graham, and I live in Graham. In fact, I live near the plant. They're great neighbors, have no objection. But Madam Chairman, I'm concerned with the way this hearing has come about, and I want to outline some of those concerns that are relevant to this agenda item, as well as I understand that you have added something to the agenda where a sort of more broad discussion will also take place.
That's correct.
But for this one, I want to say, Madam Chairman, the problem is the structure of the announcement, announcing this public hearing and notifying the public of this public hearing, is woefully inadequate, totally insufficient for the public to know. The two gentlemen who spoke must have great antenna, or perhaps read some of the Alamance News online, but there's been no information provided about this specific proposal in terms of the price tag of what the county was interested to propose, what the company was going to build, and no indication prior to today of its job impact, or in apparently this case, the lack thereof. And this is a change in the county's practice. I've had this discussion with Mr. Haygood. I've had this discussion briefly, a little bit with the chairman, but I want to raise it more broadly, that the county's change under Mr. Haygood's practice is to leave the public with absolutely no information about what's going on. And so, in essence, you're inviting the public to show up at this meeting for a pig in a poke type of incentives agreement, because they're not told how much the incentives are ahead of time, what the company's plans are in terms of investment ahead of time, nor the employment impact ahead of time. And I think this makes the public at a tremendous disadvantage, as kind of you can tell from the previous speakers, that it's not without controversy, the whole area of economic incentives. And therefore, it seems to me the county needs to be especially transparent in being forthcoming about what is being planned, proposed, or to be considered, so that the public is not at such a disadvantage. I want to confess, and we'll talk about it maybe more in the general discussion, obviously, as a newspaper and on behalf of the press, we don't like all the secrecy that surrounds the preliminaries of the discussions about incentives. Our position is all of it should be open to begin with. But we recognize the statutes in North Carolina allow for preliminary discussions and negotiation, I guess, with the county, between the county and any company, to be conducted confidentially. But once the county crosses the line, as Mr. Williams brought the proposal to the commissioners, I think it was 2 weeks ago, that a specific request is pending and a public hearing is being set, then we cross the line, Madam Chairman and Commissioners, into an area in which the public needs to be made aware of the specifics. And in this case, the current county manager has gone back on the county's previous policy. I want to present to each of you both a sort of written version of some of these comments, as well as some examples of previous hearing notices that came from this same board, from county government, about hearings that were to be held. That were to be held in the past, and you'll see, if you peruse them, that the tremendous difference between this one and previous one. The only commendation I can give to the county manager in this change in policy is that at least it got better than last year's. Last year, he wouldn't even acknowledge the name of the company in the notice. So again, the public is being told there's going to be a public hearing about some company that's going to show up at a certain time to present an incentives package, and no information about who it is, what they want, or what the county is considering giving. To me, this is rather preposterous on its face, and certainly defeats the purpose of having a public hearing. I should emphasize, and I've quoted it in the letter, the statute under the public records law, which simultaneously allows some of the preliminary discussions to be confidential, simultaneously provides that there much that other public records and the records, once we cross into an official proposal, are supposed to be open, are supposed to be available to the public. They are the public's records. I also think it's important to note, and I will preface it by also confessing I'm not a lawyer, but I think that the board needs to be careful and needs to consult carefully with its attorney on whether specific incentive programs, in fact, do comply with the statute. Again, with all deference to the company, which I think is an outstanding company and produces great products, employs many Alamance County residents, the decision in 1996, the so-called Moretti decision, largely required that there be a two-prong aspect to economic incentives, that being a capital investment and an increase in job impact. Again, I didn't know this till today because it wasn't in any of the previous material, but based on the outline that's been presented to the commissioners, there is no job impact. And thus, it's questionable as to whether the incentives agreement would withstand a legal challenge based on the Moretti ruling. I was not familiar with this till recently when a municipal attorney pointed out something called Coates Canons, which is a blog that the Institute of Government produces on a lot of public topics, municipal and county government. And one of those that deals in these areas of economic incentives also points out the danger and the questionable legality of incentives that do not include both the money and the job impact. Madam Chairman, I appreciate your entertaining these comments, the ones that are both specific to the Honda agreement as well as the process that brought us here. I do hope, and maybe the following discussion will bring it out more, that the county will return to its more open policy, more transparent policy, more informative policy that previously existed, and eliminate this secrecy that Mr. Haygood has interjected into the way this hearing was set up. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you,
Tom. Thank you for this information. Is there anybody else who wants to be heard about the Honda Power Equipment Project? If not, may we have a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. So that concludes the public hearing for the Honda Power Equipment. Now we'll move on to agenda item 9-1, discussion of the economic incentive agreement itself. And we still have the representatives of the company, and Mac Williams is still here. Do you need to be, do you wish to be heard about the agreement itself at this time, though?
Not about the agreement.
Okay. So, anybody want to start?
I think Honda's been a great community company that worked well in our community, helped a lot of various nonprofits, done a lot of things. You know, I'm with Mr. Bundy on this one, believe it or not. Anyhow, I think without the job incentive part, I have a difficulty with this, and I appreciate you wanting to invest more in your plant here. Thank you for that. And hopefully you will still do that, and as pointed out by Mr. Vines, hopefully the corporate tax rates will help cover that too. So that's pretty much all I have to say.
All right.
I'd like to ask, to say two things to Henry and Sam, if you don't mind. Bob, I did yield to you. You want to go ahead, or you want to? You go ahead. I'm fine.
Well, I want to respond to those two as well. But
First of all, you made reference to why don't we address our legislators?
Yes, sir.
And to coincide, or it's parallel, or definitely germane to what you said, why don't we be first? In 2010, July the 19th, 2010, I introduced a resolution asking our state and federal government to take us out of the bidding war. It was a good resolution. That resolution passed 3-2, and you voted for it, I voted for it, and Bill, were you? You voted for it.
No, I think I did.
Yeah. Well, it was 3-2.
Yeah.
And I don't believe you voted against it if you're on the board, but it was 3-2. And it was the first that I know of in the state to formally request that the state stop this stuff. So it's been done, but to no avail. I met and talked to, and he came here. I don't know when he came here. And Mac, this is a question to you, please, if you would. That resolution was passed July the 19th of 2010. I'm not sure if Orr was here that night. Orr is was a 10-year member of the state Supreme Court. And he and I, Beverly Lake, couldn't be two more conservatives on the bench at the state Supreme Court. Voted against allowing what was going on in Winston-Salem with the incentives. It was five Democrats and two Republicans. Clearly, I, Beverly Lake, and Robert Orr. Orr is highly regarded. Now, I didn't know till last night, believe it or not, that 1 month after we passed our resolution here, that he came to Burlington and had a debate with Ernest Pearson, and you introduced him at the inaugural event of the Leadership Alamance. And I'll be honest about it, I didn't know that. I don't think I'd have missed that, even if I'm not a member of the chamber. But can you tell me a little bit about that debate? And was the county informed of that debate? And did any county officials show up at that debate?
I don't know that 2010, but it was a membership-based event. If it was a Leadership Alamance event, then it was an event for the chamber and chamber members in that program. It wasn't a public event. But we did invite both sides. We invited Ernie Pearson, who was in the Department of Commerce previously, and then an attorney with Sanford Holzhausen Law Firm, who came to speak in favor of incentives and why they work and how they work, and then Mr. Orr on the other side. So we tried to bring both sides, but it was not a public event for public consumption. It was a specific event for chamber-related people involved in that specific event.
County management not being invited to that, though, or that. Are we not members?
We are a member, but it was for the Leadership Alamance group. It was a very specific small group of people at the time. It was a program for that group,
who have that type of...
Well, forgive me, but we pay them. The county pays if approved. I can't comprehend that that debate would take place, especially knowing that some of the debate is going on at our desk. The resolution had just been passed 30 days earlier, saying stop it. And we're not even there. I can't comprehend it. I would have slept overnight to have heard what Orr had to say. Can you give me a little gist of the debate? How long did it last? Was it filmed? Was it recorded?
I don't think it was filmed or recorded. It was a live, conversation between the two people to the end of the scene.
How long did it last?
Just about an hour, I guess, if that's the best I can recall. I don't recall it, to tell you the truth. I mean, I recall the event because I remember bringing them here or asking them both to attend. But outside of that, I don't recall the specifics of it. Or the
I said plenty couldn't do that.
I don't know.
You could come. Well, forgive me, but I didn't see this the last night on my couch at about 11 o'clock. And I almost fell off the couch. There's a picture of you introducing the two.
I remember it was at the, I think, St. Mark's Church.
Yeah. Okay, I had to ask.
Maybe they can re-react that.
You done?
Yeah, you're well for now. Yeah.
Well, I'd like to give it a slightly different perspective. And Mr. Mosier knows my perspective because we've debated this on the phone many times.
No,
probably
twice.
Only twice? It seems like it was more than that. I'm interested in economic expansion in our community because that's a way of increasing our tax base, which is going to help us keep our tax rates low. These incentive packages do not cost us money, other than if you consider if a company would come anyways without the incentive package, then it's costing us money. But that's a pretty big gamble. And we heard from the leaders at the local Honda plant that they don't have to come here. Their bosses are also considering providing this extra capacity in Japan or somewhere.
China.
And so look at the companies that we've been able to bring here. And you can say, well, they would have come anyways, but I don't know if that's true. Honda Aero, Walmart, Lidl, Prescient, Canbro, may I question the name of the cookie company?
Lotus,
thank you. And we think that Alamance County is just, everybody wants to come here because we got two interstates and we got, you know, good workers and all this. Well, so do thousands and thousands of other communities. We're competing against the entire country, not just other counties in North Carolina. And even in North Carolina, we're competing with a lot of other companies or counties. So I was at a Commissioners Association meeting this past week, and we heard a report that it was a meeting of the Tax and Finance Committee and the Public Education Steering Committee. The Tax and Finance Steering Committee brought a speaker from Burke County, that's Morganton. Well, Burke County has lost all these jobs, just like Alamance County did, mostly because of textiles moving out. And so they are now getting into the economic incentive business, and now they've landed three international companies. Are all three have labor foreign country companies. But the point is that if you don't have a concerted effort as a community to be open for business and being friendly for business expansion, then we're going to be losing out. And there are a lot of examples of counties in this state that don't have the benefit of the economic programs and expansion that we have here. And that's just so important. Look at It just as an example of how we're competing across the country, I think Randolph County, in conjunction with Guilford, just lost that Toyota Mazda opportunity to Alabama, was it? We lost the Mercedes plant to Alabama, North Carolina did. That's just the way our economy is working right now. We're competing. I mean, we're a country that competes. And this is just another level of competition as far as I'm concerned. Um,
So I want to respond to Mr. Bowen. I don't know how to respond to your comment. I mean, I think that we ought to be as transparent as we can, and certainly we ought to be in compliance with any regulatory requirements or statutory requirements, constitutional requirements. And I don't know about the adding the jobs, if that's a requirement of the law or not. Even without adding more jobs, just the fact that they would be expanding it, it cash flows to us. So, I mean, just to be, so everybody's clear, the incentives that we pay out are more than offset by the tax revenue that we get. So it's not really helping to increase anybody's tax bill. It might, if they would have come anyways, then maybe the tax bill could have been lower. But I think that's a pretty big gamble that these companies would have come without the incentives. I feel pretty strongly that most of them would have gone somewhere else. It's hard to prove. So that's my position on this kind of
thing. I want to get my comments. Here in Alamance County, we support our businesses and our community, and we do that through economic development. The only way we can support our schools and everything else in the county is with the money that comes in from taxes. And the people pay a lot of the taxes. But the incentives keeps jobs here in Alamance County. I support this position to support Honda, and I always will.
All right, thank you. Mr. County Manager, I just had a couple of questions for you, or maybe for Mac, about this particular project and its impact. So we have $10.5 million for the building, and sort of a question mark about whether or not there's going to be equipment. But if there is equipment, we'll incentivize it up to $10.5 million. Is that right?
That's correct.
So if they don't do any equipment, if they only end up investing the $10.5 million for the building, we'll be paying them $31,500 a year for 5 years.
That's
right. Right? For a total of $157,500. That's what we'll get.
That's right.
After the facility is in place and taxes are being paid on it.
That's right.
Okay,
it's not upfront in advance. It's a performance-based grant, which means the taxes from the facility begin to be paid, and then the grant is paid once the taxes begin to roll in. So it's not an upfront hoping for the best situation. It's a performance-based grant.
After 5 years, the county will be $147,000 in the green, right?
That's correct. If they invest the entire amount, the $10.5 million in the building, we would be $147,000 to the good even after the incentive pay.
So we don't lose any money by giving the incentives. We ended up still, the Honda does what they say they're going to do, and we have a mechanism set up to make sure that they do that, then we don't lose any money as a county. Is that right?
That's correct.
Okay. And I remember, and we're going to have a separate agenda item coming here in a little bit about reviewing the economic development incentive policy as in its entirety, or as a whole policy, and we're going to, I hope, address Mr. Boney's questions then about the notices given. But if I recall from my friends at the Farm Bureau, for every dollar that's paid in property tax, a single family home uses about more or less a dollar in services. Is that right?
$1.32
in services. For every dollar that's paid in property tax for multifamily, like apartments, they use more than that in services, I think.
That was all lumped in together now, as services to residents.
To residents.
Right. Then it was 50-some% toward the rural part, and 16-18%, I think it was.
Right, so for every dollar in property tax paid by industry,
18 or 22, I can't remember.
It's quite a bit less.
Yes.
Like less than 80 cents used.
So 80 cents going toward the people living in the houses from the industries.
Right, so industry uses less of the property tax in services than they actually pay into it.
That's correct.
That's correct.
My goodness.
So those are the reasons that I support this particular project, because it is a net green to the county of $147,000 over 5 years, and then after the 5 years, it'll be increasing beyond that once the incentive package term is over. And then also because industry uses, they don't put anybody in the school system, and they don't usually call out the sheriff's department for their domestic abuse problems and things like that. So that's my position on this particular project. Is there any more discussion?
Yes, I'd like to challenge you on your premises.
Okay.
You are saying we're not losing any money. That is quite an assumption. There's two levels of, what's the word I'm going to use? There's two levels here. Either you believe that they would definitely leave if we didn't give it to them, or that they'll definitely stay if we do give it to them. Whatever. I mean, I'm sure I'm messing it up somehow. But you're assuming they would leave. I'm assuming they would stay. You're assuming that the majority, or if you're putting out there, dialogue, rhetoric, with all due respect, I don't mean it to be a negative word, but you're putting rhetoric out there that they would leave. The majority would leave, so you've got to pay it. I put out the rhetoric that I believe the majority would stay. So I believe that we lose money, if my position is correct, and you believe we lose money. If mine is correct. I'm sure I messed that up somewhere. But the point is you have to weigh what you think's out there in the ozone with these deals. We didn't lose Randolph County deal because of money. I don't believe that we lost Mercedes because of money. And I just believe that you have to weigh, in my opinion, the way I look at it, you have to weigh, in all honesty, my premise is government doesn't need to be involved in this. It's free enterprise. We're not supposed to be out there. I mean, I read a case not long ago where a competitor was seeing, a guy was seeing a competitor of his getting incentives. And he said, man, you're running me out of business. Government is paying this guy money to help run me out of business. And I've said it all along, a banker would go to jail for doing exactly what government is doing. If a banker went out to a payroll, to an industry and said, you give me your payroll, I'll give you cash, I'll give you $250,000, I'll give you $100,000. The banker knows what he's going to do with that payroll. He knows the profit he's going to make off that payroll. It's the same thing. It's just looks different. So I said it, and I stick to it. Government, a banker would go to jail for doing this. But it's okay for government to do it. And this has nothing to do with Ponte. Trust me. This is just principles, government, good government, bad government, involvement we should be in or should not be in. But I'll say this, and I'll be quiet, and I'm going to vote no. I've lost for years on this debate. And I'm going to continue to lose until we get some people, in my opinion, who see it the way John Locke Foundation sees it, the way Civitas sees it, the way I Beverly Lake saw it, and the way Robert Orr saw it. Tim Sutton's not out here in some right-wing fringe camp with crazy opinions. I've got some good people and good institutions in North Carolina Institute of Constitutional Law that say we should be doing this. So I think your assumption that we lose money is incorrect. I think my assumption is they would stay is the right thing. But and I'm sure you don't agree with that, and that's fine. But somehow we have to vote yes or no. So,
Mr. Sutton, I do. I agree that, that's, I think you phrased it very well, that you essentially, we are kind of looking to the ozone and trying to protect the behavior of people that we don't know what they're going to do. And I respect your opinion, and I respect the way that you phrased it. I don't have a problem with what you said. We all have to vote our conscience in the way that
and I respect
it. I don't want to agree with that. You
framed it well, is which assumptions you think are correct. And that's what it comes down to. I do want to comment about the losing of like Mercedes and Toyota. It wasn't about the money necessarily, but it illustrates that other places are very attractive to people, not necessarily because of the money, but because of a lot of other factors besides North Carolina and besides Alamance County.
Well, you know what they did for Mercedes? Just for information. They waived, what was it? The mother plant, now Mac, you might correct me on this. If I'm not mistaken, they waived taxes at the state level on the mother plant for like 20 years or something. And the satellites that all came in to supply them, which is what got the Guilford County, Randolph County deal, they had suppliers down in South Carolina that they could link up to. That's what that deal was all about. But the suppliers, the satellites down in Alabama were waived taxes for 12 years. It wasn't local money that did it. Of course, we're not talking about a deal that big either. But they put a school tax on because they knew there those people were going to bring in families and populate the school. So the people in Alabama told me they had a school on every corner if they wanted it, basically. That's what I was told. But anyway, that, you know, I'm glad we had
it. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's, so it's ideology versus pragmatism in my mind.
Whatever, yeah.
Madam Chairman, I have a technical question. The way you've described it, I'm not clear. 10.5 is the investment assumption. If, for any reason, the company does not make that, is it but does do something, is it a prorated reduction in the county's contribution or a threshold where they get nothing if they don't do 10.5?
This is prorated.
So their investment's prorated.
Thank you.
Chairman, I got one, but I may be related to it. I have a copy here that was published, and according to what I have here, it says there's supposed to be a 10 new full-time jobs averaging above the county average wage. That's the county policy. Is that incorrect?
Mr. Vines, that is the county policy, and we'll be talking about that a little bit later in the agenda.
How can you approve this one if no jobs are associated with it?
Because the policy doesn't bind the commissioners to any particular project. It's a guideline. It's not a fixed thing. So if they came in with a $100 million project and no block, no jobs, we could still approve that too. There's a line in there somewhere.
Oh, it's got back doors and back windows, I'll assure you, because I asked Brian Hayden the same question.
Mr. Williams?
Just one point about the jobs. True, no new jobs have been suggested by this project, but the retention of existing jobs, I want to emphasize that point about this. It's not like they're going to leave, but there is new technology, there's a transition to a new way of building new machinery. The retention of the people that are currently employed are as valuable a job as a new job that might be coming with a project. And so I just want to reemphasize the fact that while there aren't any new jobs, the retention of, there's some 132 positions that are in the current machining operation that will have to be retrained for what, if the new production equipment comes in, those will be retrained opportunities. And so I want to just reemphasize, yes, no new jobs, not trying to act like there are new jobs, but the retention of existing jobs is also a valuable and viable consideration where jobs are concerned, I think.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question about that?
Sure.
So I guess that what we're talking about is technology is making you more efficient. So it's becoming, per unit of bill, becoming less people dependent. And so that you can expand and build more units of product in this new space without adding people because of technology and automation. And if you don't expand, then there's a risk of you having to reduce your force over time because of the implementation of technology, but without the expansion, perhaps.
Okay.
Well, I'm just trying to get a feel for the there is a risk of losing employees, so you're talking about retaining employees, which we, would be good for us if we could retain all the employees.
I think when you add to, will be for additional projects that plan something different. So the employees that's working with the current will move over to the new part.
All right, do we have a motion that's ready to be made?
I'll move that we approve this economic development project.
I'll second.
Thank you. So we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
No.
All right, thank you very much. So let's go on to action item number 9-2, proclamation for National Literacy Action Week.
Madam Chair, what was the vote count there?
It was 3-2.
Thank you.
All right, National Literacy Action Week.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, February 1st through February 8th is National Literacy Action Week, and we have all kinds of different events and things to celebrate literacy and bring awareness to the need for various literacy skills throughout the county. And we have submitted a proclamation for National Literacy Action Week that it is the right of all citizens to have access to literacy.
Great, and I have that proclamation here, which I will read for National Literacy Action Week. Whereas acquiring and improving literacy skills throughout life is an intrinsic part of the right to education, and whereas literacy empowers people, enables them to participate fully in society and contributes to improved livelihoods, and whereas literacy is also a driver for sustainable development in that it enables greater participation in the labor market, improved child and family health and nutrition, reduces poverty and expands life opportunities, and whereas beyond its conventional concept is a set of reading, writing, and counting skills, literacy is now understood as a means of identification, understanding, interpretation, creation, and communication in an increasingly digital, text-mediated, information-rich, and fast-changing world. Now, therefore, let it be known to all present that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners hereby recognizes literacy as a right and proclaims February 1st through February 8th, 2018 as National Literacy Action Week in Alamance County. So, that is the proclamation. And I believe that if the board so pleases to adopt this proclamation, we would need to vote. Is there any discussion?
I'll move to adopt it.
And I'll second it.
Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, now we have a library request from Ms. Wilkerson to spend performance management savings.
Thank you. We would like to use some of our performance management savings. We have about $86,000 in our PM savings fund, and we would like to designate $10,850, I believe is what the request was for, to be used to train our youth services staff initially in outcome-based planning and evaluation. Part of this training will help us as our youth services people develop goals that will support our strategic plan, which includes making us an integral part of the educational system and offering innovative and educational literacy-based programs. The outcomes-based evaluation and planning helps us identify what the needs are and be intentional about our programming. We've worked with a consultant who is a former youth services librarian for the State Library of North Carolina, and she's helped us put together an outline and a base for doing this. Once we have the youth services staff trained, then we will carry that over into the adult services staff, and our youth services people will then do the training internally so that it's the root of all of our programming, so that we understand that what we're doing is what we are intended to do.
I'd like to move that we approve it, and I'd like to say that I really like what MJ is proposing, because it's a pretty modest amount, and she could have used that money for a lot of other things, but she chose to use it for improving the capacity and the effectiveness of the library program. I think it would be money well spent.
Okay, so we have a motion to spend the savings. Do we have a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. I think we also need to have a vote to amend your budget to reflect that amount. In discussion prior to the meeting, that was thought that yes, that would be a timely thing to do now.
Yes.
So what I think that we would need is a motion to amend the budget to reflect the amount that is spent.
That is correct.
So moved.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right. Let's just ask briefly, next on the agenda is our review of the economic development incentive policy. Is it the pleasure of the board that we take a brief recess? Or are y'all?
Just fine.
Comfortable with the
meeting?
I'm all right. Okay, great. Just wanted to ask. Well, if that changes, you know, we're fine. I don't know. Okay, so so we're going to consider today whether or not we're going to review and consider revising our economic development incentive policy. Sort of three big things to consider. One, in the policy, what is the best way to notify the public about what we're going to be doing with our economic incentive project? When should the public get informed about what's in being considered, what's being contemplated, and how much information should be made available to the public and at what time? So that's one thing to consider. Another thing to consider is we have people who object to economic incentives as a matter of principle. Those are considerations that deserve to be aired and heard. If we do decide that we're going to agree to continue to offer incentives for economic development, then we could consider what's the minimum investment that a company would need to commit to in order to receive the incentives. Currently, our policy is for $2 million of either real or equipment type investment, real property or equipment investment, and 10 jobs is in the policy. So I'll just open it up to discussion with the board. What's your pleasure? And how to
we've already proven today that the policy that we got is not adhered to. I mean, you and I talked when I first saw the policy, and you know, pretty much, you know, tone was there's all kind of, you didn't say it, I said it, I guess, or I thought it, back doors, windows, and these are just suggested.
Madam Chair, if I could speak just briefly about how we're currently doing business. So since I've been manager, my goal has been to try to provide some consistency to how we release this information. Notice, you know, one of the most important parts of this is the public hearing notice that we put out. You know, Mac comes before we're starting to talk to a company, and they're ready to engage us with negotiations about incentives, and he gives the board the name of the company and requests that a public hearing be set at the next county commission meeting. And then we put out a public hearing notice announcing that is coming, that today will happen, and that Honda Fire Equipment will be here. And what I had noticed early on was there was some inconsistency in the information we put in the public notice. Sometimes in the past we have put the company's name. Sometimes, particularly if we've partnered with another city, if I'm not mistaken, the county is the only local government entity in Alamance County that does this, that says the company's name that early and before the public hearing. I've noticed in the past if we partnered with another city, we may not have put the name of the company in the public notice using their format. So there was some inconsistency in how we put out information. So since I've been manager, what I've interpreted our policy to say is the public notice after Mac comes goes out, as it did this time, with the company's name, but then we don't put out any other information about the details of the project, how many possible jobs may be coming, or how much possible investment there may be until the contract has been negotiated between the county and the industry, and then it goes in the packet that goes out to each one of you. So what happened this time in particular, we put out the public notice with just the company name, then we put out the packet, we put the contract in the packet that has all the details, how much is going to be invested, and also included the cover sheet where I write that, and I try to pull out some of the more pertinent parts of the contract for folks to be able to consume a little bit easier. That is the way I'm interpreting the current policy, and I think that's one of the major issues at hand today. We have some folks in the press that don't feel like that is an adequate amount of notice. You know, the packets go out on Thursday. I will tell you that the contract did not go in the packet this time due to a software malfunction. We had so many iterations of this information that the contract, the software didn't pick it up, and I apologize for that. It did go out Friday. But what I've talked to Mr. Williams about is I would recommend to the chair not to have a public meeting if the information has not gone in the packet. Because I do agree the public needs the opportunity to see this data. But we're trying to balance the public's right and need to know with the company's desire to keep this information confidential for whatever reasons they have. We don't know all those reasons. So that's the way I'm interpreting the policy. I've talked with Clyde, and we both agree that is the correct interpretation of this policy. It is also compliant with state law. So if the board has a good thing to talk about today, if one thing for me to take away that would be very helpful is if you as a board have a different way you would like for me to handle how this information is released to the public, please, I can do it however you want. That's the way I interpret the policy now, but I do want to be consistent because Mac is telling the companies what to expect. When they start this process, he meets with them and he tells them, he comes to the Board of Commissioners and releases their name 10 or 2 weeks before the public notice. So they're expecting that, but I don't believe they're expecting all this data to be out at that time. They do know the contract goes in the packet, so they're prepared then. But yes, sir.
Well, Mr. Boney, when he passed out with some examples of notices from the past few years, and in those notices are the amounts of the packages.
Yes.
So, and you're suggesting that we don't do that at all, even if the negotiations have been completed by the time the notice goes out?
The notice goes out very early. It goes out, I believe, 10 days prior to the public hearing, and some of these, my experience is limited with these, but the ones that I have been experienced with, the negotiations of the terms are right up to the very last moment. My policy internally is the packet must be ready, the contract must be in the packet if we haven't finished negotiating, but that packet doesn't go out until Thursday.
Right.
So I would not feel comfortable putting that information in the public hearing notice because it may change. And if we're going to do that, if the board says, Brian, I want you to do that, then we have to make sure that Mac is telling the company that too. They need to be told it's not going to be just their name, which right now that is what they're being told, if I'm not mistaken. If we're going to do something different by putting the number of jobs or the possible amount of capital investment in the public notice, we all need to be on the same page with the chamber to make sure Mac's telling the company that too. What I'm interpreting it right now, and from my experience, what I've seen in these contract negotiations, I'm doing my part saying I would tell the chair, cancel the public meeting if the contract is not in the packet, because that gives everyone plenty of time to see what the details are. But they are sometimes negotiated right up to the 11th hour.
So. Well, we're splitting hair and begging the issue here. No offense, you're acting as if the people are barely even with the business or barely even with the chamber. I say it's a lot different. The people are up here, the chamber and the businesses are here. It's the people that pay the taxes, and it's the people, this is where it's coming from, their pockets. And I say it's not equal. It's up here. And at the very least, we should vote on a separate day once it is all transparent. In other words, to come in here at 9 o'clock and have it presented at 9:15 to where everybody knows the dollars. No offense, Isaac didn't even know there were no jobs being offered. Well, the public needs to know that, in my opinion. And before the vote and a day before, weeks before the vote. And then we come in here
and
vote.
And that may be a way to do business, yeah, as to have Matt Green to ask to us and then have a public hearing at night, thank you, Henry, because I think there are more people that may respond. I don't know.
If I understand right, Mr. Sutton, from what Mr. Haygood was saying, is that if it's in the contract is ready, it's prepared. We know what the deal is going to be on Monday morning or night. On Thursday at noon, when the agenda goes out, then that would give the media an access to know what's in the package.
I disagree, because the papers, weekend papers, go to them. They put it in a can on Friday, and everybody knows that. And it's got to be more noticeable, in my opinion.
That's the way I interpret the policy now, is just the name on the public notice, and the contract must be in the packet when it's released, and the contract has all the data. Again, that's from the policy that was approved in 2009. You know, if you want to change the policy, that is absolutely the prerogative of the board, and we can bring you back a revamped policy after listening to these discussions today, that we can say, okay, here are the changes we've heard you say you might want. Let's talk about that. We're certainly amenable to do that, however the board wants to handle.
Well, I'd want to hear feedback from the chamber president.
I was going to ask Mr. Williams if he would come forward and give us since you're our economic development person, if you would give us your perspective about how, sure, in working with business, what do businesses come to expect?
Well, first of all, let me begin by saying and reminding everyone that this isn't, the chamber is your agent. And so the policy and the procedures that you dictate are going to be how this works will be what I follow. So I'm working for the county. I try to work with the companies, Mr. Sutton, to try to facilitate the process so that we end up being competitive, and so it's customer service. So in that regard, I do work with the companies very closely to try to guide them through the process of what to expect, because every county is different, or counties try to be different. They try to follow the state. Everybody in North Carolina's got the state law standard to follow, everybody, including the timing of incentives, the timing of the notices, the amount of information to go into the notice. All of that is something all 100 counties in North Carolina have to follow. How they do it in Alabama, I don't know, or South Carolina, is all different, where all the states are different. There's no national standard that all counties and all local governments have to follow where the policy and procedure is concerned. But there are basic state laws that have to be followed, and Alamance County competes with all other 99 counties at the basic level that the state statutes require. What Alamance County has already done to be more stringent than state statutes require is the step that I have to take with coming to you guys 2 weeks prior to the hearing, at a minimum of two weeks prior and just to say the company name. After Mr. Boney made other comments back in the day, I don't remember when this started, but I remember the upshot being that can we at least know who we're talking about, and give us 2 weeks to look to see about who we're talking about dealing with. And so that was a concession made to the standard that all the other counties in North Carolina followed. I don't know if there's more notice than that other places might give, but I know that we have to tell the companies. Now, so I have to start working with the company about this extra step that we have to take here versus where they might be having to not take it somewhere else. And even local, the cities that are involved just put a notice in a public notice in the paper 10 days in advance, and then the hearings occur where, for the first time, sometimes the city folks hear what the details are. In this particular case today, as Brian said, that's not always the case, but often can be the case, that the companies themselves are still working internally on what information do they want to be public, and therefore be included in these public documents. And that happened this time. About where we started off thinking it was going to be one thing, and then the company said, well, we're not ready yet, we're not ready yet. So we had to accommodate that. So I guess my point in all of this, both to the policy and the procedure, is that not only is the incentive, whatever it might be, an important factor, but the procedure to attain it is also part of the competitive picture that is considered here. If we make it harder and harder to do an incentive, then it might be that it's easier to get the same or maybe even less somewhere else, then that might be a factor at some point. I can't tell you every time, but I'm just saying to you that as you consider policy and procedure, how competitive is it for us to compete against our competition? That should, I think, in how customer service oriented is it? Because the customer service to the county is going to be added tax base, added or retained jobs. And by the way, job retention is in their existing industry, and their policy does say retention. But at any rate, my big picture recommendation and suggestion and feedback is remembering that all of this is competitive.
I guess specifically is having the terms of the agreement as part of the agenda packet problematic, do you think?
Well, at that point, no, because in my counseling, to call it, for lack of a better term for that, as I'm working with these folks about what to expect, it does come to the point where we are, I'm putting Clyde and Andrea and Brian in direct contact with the company representative to negotiate the performance agreement. Because I agree, and I tell them that if you're asking for public funds to help you with this project, the whole point of all this is to put this out in the public so that the public understands and can have a chance to comment on it. And so it's codified in this agreement. And so I tell them what the agreement is about. I tell them the timing of how the agreement needs to, the date where the agreement needs to be finished. I tell them that when their company name is going to be public, that they need to be prepared for all this. And to work fairly expeditiously on their side to turn the agreement around. I know Clyde, with everything he had going on 10 days ago, here's one more thing, and by the way, it needs to hurry. Because we need to get it to them, and they need to do their internals about it to get it right on their side, and come back with an edit or two, and back and forth. And so they understand that there is a date where they already understand there's a date where their company name is going to be made public. But I do tell them, under the current policy as it currently exists, as we've all understood it, that's the only bit of information at this point.
So if we put the financial information in the public notice, if it were available, and that's 10 days in advance?
At least.
That would be more problematic
working
with the companies, or you'd be okay with that?
No. What I would do is I would say, this is the information that's going to be public at this time. And if all the details of the contract are going to be in the notice, then I would tell my customer what to expect in terms of details of the project and when it's going to be available, so that they can be prepared to handle it. And if it becomes problematic, and that's why I start talking about incentives and the process for it early on, so that I can understand if there's going to be any timing bottlenecks here, because I don't want, one of the things I try to say to folks in presentations about this is that so much about being successful in these ventures is out of our control. So it behooves us, I think, to be really good at what we can control and how we do it, which is policy and procedure. We can control that. And to the extent that we can be competitive with what our policies and procedures are, we ought to endeavor to do it, because so much else that goes into us being successful is out of our control. But nevertheless, and there is that baseline standard that all 100 counties have to follow with respect to all of this. And with respect to confidentiality or secrecy, as the other term is used, I would argue that there is a point in the statutes that call for the transparency. There are several points. There's the first point is when I come 2 weeks prior and just at least say the company name. Nobody that I know of is, that we're competing against has to do that. So we're already doing that. That's the first step of transparency. And then there's going to be the packet that goes out Thursday before the meeting. And then there's the hearing itself. So there's three steps where there's growing elements of transparency all along the way. But, you know, confidentiality is a temporary condition in the process because it's a dynamic process. Information is going back and forth. Decisions are being made. And that period is important for it's important to have confidentiality in that period so that the company can make a final decision on what it wants to act on or be acted upon. And that because that is dynamic and it does change. But at some point that's done and it's time to be public and be transparent about all that information, and that's what the process is set up to serve. And so, you know, confidentiality is a temporary operating condition. It's not a permanent obfuscation of the law or the public's right to know. I would say to you that, in my opinion, that confidentiality is as much of a tool that's necessary for competitive economic development as the anonymous source is a necessary tool for competitive journalism. Would you give up the right to have an anonymous source?
Mr. Williams.
Sorry. We're all in competitive businesses, and I respect wanting to get the information out to the public. I do. There are steps in place where that occurs.
Do you think there's any effort at all on the part of people in this process to circumvent government, to circumvent the people, to just put it out there where that's just a hoop we got to jump through? You know, if you went to the businesses, in my opinion, and said, look, when we walk up there and give a two-week notice, we got to lay it all out on the table. That's the policy. Mm-hmm. I don't see where that jeopardizes. I mean, it is deal. I mean, we knew, I have to believe you knew when you came up here to ask the public, yeah, there's going to be no jobs. And I can't imagine that anybody thinks that's a competition scenario, because it appears to me to be something more like, well, we really don't want that out there yet, publicly. We don't want the press to get a hold of this. And I'm telling you to put this in a packet on Thursday, that we might not get the Thursday afternoon, or not even see it at all, or Friday or Saturday, is just not sufficient. I think the whole deal ought to be on the table the very day. One meeting prior to the meeting that we're supposed to vote. I can't imagine that would be a delay that's dangerous in this process for you, mm-hmm. or the county in negotiating the deal.
And I would say, generally speaking, that all companies do ultimately get to the point where they understand all of this has to be out there if what they want to do as part of the process is to get incentives at a county level or a city level or a state level or all three, which is more often the case than today was unusual also in the sense that just Alamance County is the only jurisdiction involved here. Oftentimes, and this is another thing to think about as we're trying to determine our competitive stature, is the actions we take and or don't take, and our policies and procedures often are in concert with, including timing and disclosure of what cities that may also be in the hunt, like Mebane or Burlington or Graham, and the state are doing. They all have their processes and timing and steps and procedures as well, and so we're having to choreograph all of that simultaneously, more or less. And so, to your point, yes, I think companies do understand there's a point where it's all got to be out on the table. But the extent to which we make it a challenge beyond what others are having to make them do, just from a competitive standpoint, the procedure of it all, and the time, and the timing is part procedure, and notice is part procedure. I just ask you to think about that as you think about policy and procedure, to consider the competitiveness of it all, and that that is much of a part of the competitiveness as whatever amount of money might be involved. That's really my only point. But I don't disagree, and there is a point where I, in my facilitating the process with a potential customer, that this is the process here, and this is the timing of it all, and this is what you have to expect and be ready to do. And so the more time I have, the easier it is. When I don't have a lot of time, everybody gets pressed, including the customer. Does that help?
Yeah, my opinion on that is that if we could just set a deadline as to when this information would be in our packet, like a Monday prior to meeting, you got a week to digest it. As a commission, we have that long to look at it, think about it, because I know it's hard to get them to put those numbers, but I think they know when they come for the ask, they have a real judge.
When they show up here, then they already have put a number that's gone into the fact that has been negotiated.
Right.
That's already done. That is true. That is done.
And if we can put that out to the public a week prior to them having it finalized in our package.
Do you think that would be a problem to put it out a week ahead of time?
No, that's what's going on now.
I think that
was supposed to be Thursday. It's not a week before.
Yeah.
If it goes public on Thursday, Tom Bodie can't even put it in his paper. Now, the Bourbon Times can. But I'd like to see it at least a week before the Thursday.
Put a Monday deadline, and then the next week we have it as part of our
package. Whatever date the commissioners say, right now the contract says, I mean, the policy says it'll be negotiated and in the packet. And I take that to mean it has to be, or it doesn't come here for public hearing. So if the commissioners say they want it a week before, that becomes our new deadline, where I'm telling Mac, be sure and tell the company, we must have a negotiated deal by a week before, or else it doesn't come to public hearing. Because my desire is to make sure it does go out to the public.
Right.
So Mac's right, there has to be a point where the numbers are known and everybody's ready to put it out. Currently, it's when the packet's released on Thursday. So if you change that, we would revamp the policy, because I would feel much more comfortable operating under a policy that the board had approved. And that would be the new deadline. A week before, I would tell Mac, tell the companies, if they don't have their stuff together and we have an agreement that's been worked out with county attorney and everybody else, a week beforehand so we can put it out, that we don't come on the proposed date.
I had a suggestion about that. I've been thinking about this question and had wondered if maybe the day before the packet goes out on Thursday, maybe on Wednesday, if we could at some time during the day do a press release where the press is made aware of a range or anticipated terms that would be within an acceptable realm for the company, and give the press the notice that they need to go to publication, and not tie up negotiations for a week ahead of time or something like that. What I've understood from the negotiations is they're continual and ongoing, and the companies are finding the deadline of the packet to be a source of friction for them. I agree with what Mr. Sutton said about balancing the interests of the company versus the interests of the public. Certainly the public's interests are paramount, and if they don't want the public's money, they don't have to come and ask for it. I agree with that principle. And in trying to balancing the need of the public, the need of business community, the need of journalism and the press to do their job in making the public aware, I would just offer that for the board's consideration, that making the whatever information that's available on Wednesday before the packet goes out, that might be a compromise that is attentive to the needs of the different parts of it.
I like that idea, if it works.
I like that idea also.
Well, yes.
It's one more day than what otherwise be if it's all on the package.
That's why, that no offense, that's why that's a joke. It's not enough time. Papers are in the can on Fridays for the weekend. They're in the can for Saturday, maybe not the Times News, but I believe I know what I'm talking about. They're in the can for Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. And you're only given the paper, who's our primary goal of being in touch with the people, and thank God good paper is going to save this country, bad papers will take us down the tubes. You're only given the papers a one-day jump on this deal, in my opinion. And that's not good enough, in my opinion. And, you know, I don't know why we can't say at least 7 business days or something more practical or pragmatic, or one meeting prior to the vote. I just can't imagine that destroys any deal, especially one like this. I'm sorry, you know, we're just trying to split hairs or placate too many people, and I'm not in the business of placating
anybody. I like the idea of being a little bit more consistent with.
I'm sorry?
I like the idea of being a little bit more consistent with the standard you talked about that's being in practice across the state, and also giving a little bit more flexibility in working with our fellow municipalities in the community on doing these so that we're all kind of timing it pretty close together.
Yeah, right now, some of our municipalities that are sometimes are involved as a partner with the county in these things only meet once a month. And so there's a scheduling and timing issue there about if we've got somebody traveling from another part of the country, another part of the world to represent the company at the hearing, right, you know, trying to line it up so that they're only here for 2 days. Or, you know, y'all meet on Mondays.
Our last meeting of the month is in the evening, maybe we that's right. There well, at the first.
That's right. But what I'm saying is on the days of the week where you're lining up a Monday and a Tuesday successively versus a Monday here and then wait another month for the second hearing for the city and the county. So that's what I'm talking about. The scheduling and the timing is really more the issue. It's not letting the information out in advance. There is a point where everybody's got to be ready for that to get the packet to get the information in the packet.
Yes, we do need we want to maintain a cutoff at staff level of when we say this is the deal. And we're telling the company we must have this negotiated by this time, this date.
Because we've got to do this with it.
Right, because we have to put it in the packet. So it's acceptable to us from staff perspective whenever the board wants to make the announcement.
But we aren't. But Alamance County's not operating in a vacuum. There's oftentimes a state and a local partner as well who have their schedules and timings. Typically, the state's got a whole other set of issues, but most of the cities here operate on the statewide basis of public notice in the paper.
If we don't address that in our policy about how we interact with this would be another good point to put in there, some wording about how we time our releases and do we give any consideration to the cities do different than we do, or the state may do different. I don't know.
I will tell you that when our policy of naming the company, when I asked for the public hearing date, when that first happened, the state has a policy of when the project is formally announced, it's got to be announced out of the governor's office, even if they're the minor player. The formal announcement still this comes through the governor's office and whatever state incentives applied. And then that's when it's a formal announcement that the company's actually saying, okay, now we're committed. Here, these are steps. When we have our local incentives processes, that's a step toward that formal announcement. These aren't the formal announcements, but early on, when I was saying the company name, it was at the state level. They went, what are you doing? You're getting out ahead. No, we're not getting out ahead. This isn't a formal announcement. It's just we're letting the public know who we're dealing with in terms of public tax money, who the customer, who the other party is, and giving the press time to evaluate who the other party is. But so we had to calm that partner down about this was an announcement. This was simply a step in the process. And that's what, when Thomas follows us out the door, does this mean it's going to be an announcement? This isn't about Thomas. This is just when he follows us out. The company's got to be careful to, you know, it's not an announcement. It's just a step, and there are other things that have to be resolved before a formal announcement can be done. So it caused everybody a little scurry when we first started talking about putting the company name out there. So that's why I think part of it was the limitation was just the company name, because we're still talking about what the numbers are going to be as we learn with this particular one today.
Well, it seemed like if you did a press release by noon on Wednesday before the meeting, if any of the papers and other media think that it's newsworthy, they'll get it in by the next day.
I guess my question would be, if we do that, if we say noon Wednesday, day before, would we want that to be the cutoff? Because then we would tell the company we must have the contract negotiated by noon Wednesday. And that's fine. We can do that. It's absolutely okay. It just means that we'll be negotiating right up until noon, and that is okay. It just, right now, we're negotiating right up until when the packet goes out. I just want to make sure that our staff understand that if we go to noon on Wednesday, that gives folks time to get it in the local papers. If the board feels that it does, then we would want to put that in and say Wednesday noon is the cutoff, not really packet time. So if we wouldn't give any, we wouldn't do any more negotiations between noon Wednesday and when the packet goes out on Thursday. And that is acceptable. We can. I just need to make sure I'm clear.
So Amy suggested that if it's not totally done by then, that say, well, these are the parameters that are on the table at this time. The detail might change by the time it gets in the packet or by the time it gets to the hearing. But at least it gives.
You might want to, Mac, I don't know if you want to comment on that.
That's involving the company on what they're willing to have said.
I think one thing that's important is to just acknowledge that companies want secrecy, not necessarily because they're trying to slip something by the taxpayer or get away with something as far as getting the public's money, but there are trade secrets involved, and they're looking at competitive advantages and disadvantages. I think that my impression from discussion is that they're not so much looking at trying to preserve secrecy in the hopes of sliding something by people, as far as the public goes, is they want to preserve secrecy because they don't want their competitors to know what they're up to.
For as long as possible. Well, there's also, you know, sometimes there are companies that are going to be perhaps closing someplace somewhere else. So they've got the existing employees there to have to consider. That's why a lot of times, actually almost every time, there's some code name associated with these projects. The company doesn't come out and say right off the bat. Some of them do, Amazon.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes it is public. That's for a reason. But in more cases than not, all these projects have a code name for a long time.
And that's understandable.
Very often, when I first meet with them, I don't know who they are. And I don't know who they are until we get to a certain point in the process, typically. And that's for confidentiality reasons, so they have lots of latitude to come to peace on their side with what the project is actually going to be, so that we have an opportunity to respond to it with whatever incentive, if at all, we're going to do.
There's a lot of moving parts, too.
A lot of moving parts for a long time.
Mr. Boney, you wanted to be heard again, please.
Yes, Madam Chairman, thank you very much. I'll try to distinguish my comments between opinion and some facts, because some of these things are getting kind of blended. Mr. Haygood consistently referred to wanting to have consistency, but Madam Chairman, what I would point out is that the inconsistency has arisen from Mr. Haygood's decision, not county policy. The county policy as it was implemented prior to his tenure was, as I've shown you in these public notices, that the information is provided about not only the company name, but also the job impact, if any, and the investment by the company, and sometimes even including what the county is going to offer. I think part of the problem, to be quite honest, let's just call it this, is that the whole process is getting very premature. They're announcing incentives proposals that haven't, in fact, been consummated. And it's not a matter of, shouldn't be a matter of rushing to get it, whether it's the Monday before, or the Wednesday before, or the Thursday before. You all should know this a long time ahead of time. Certainly about the time Mr. Williams makes the announcement that a company is ready to propose a incentives agreement, or that the county is ready to, that stuff should be known then. So the consistency the inconsistency has arisen since then. I would also distinguish the legal notice or the legal notification to the public about a public hearing. Mr. Haygood has made it doubly difficult. Not only does he not include the information in the public notice, but he withholds it from our reporters' attempts to find out public records in that interim period. So, for instance, in this case, up until Thursday, he was absolutely unwilling to provide any detail whatsoever about this Honda power equipment. And the last time, the same was true with air gas. Now, the last time, we as a newspaper were fortunate that a more open local government was involved, that being the city of Mebane, and so they complied readily with a public records request to provide the information of what they were offering, which was parallel to what the county was offering. But no thanks to county government were we able to learn that. I think it's also important to note, as I think Mr. Sutton alluded to, the company already knows what its situation is. There's no confidentiality keeping it from the company. The objective of this whole rigmarole and structure is to keep it from the Alamance County taxpayer and public. And I think that should be the most objectionable part of the whole way this has evolved under Mr. Haygood's tenure. I think it's also important to note, and this is some of the facts that I sat there listening to and just want to make. Well, the first one's an opinion, Madam Chairman, and that is the one you made, because I don't think that trade secrets have been an issue in any of the incentives agreements I can think of in any recent time here in Alamance County.
Mr. Bunny, I'll interrupt you and say you don't really know that. I mean, you don't know what kind of deliberations have been going on with the companies as far as their motivations for doing things. So neither you nor I know what role trade secrets might play into their desire to seek incentives or their desire to add to the projects.
Well, Madam Chairman, that's a little bit true prospectively, but not after the fact. The Alamance News has consistently made public records requests after the fact, both of county government and state government, to get the information that was a part of the very secret trail that led up to some sort of announcement, and those aspects would be able to be redacted because they deal with information that is allowed to be withheld. In all the ones we've looked at in the past, I do not recall any section that was redacted based on trade secret issues in practice.
Right, but you're assuming that the company would be divulging that concern to the county government. If I were owner of a corporation and I was negotiating a incentive, I might have reason not to divulge that I had trade secrets or patent problems or questions about technology and the things that we're going to use. I might not want to divulge that to the local government for a lot of reasons, one being a concern that they would leak it.
Well, but that's not a concern of any of the factors that we're interested in and that the public is broadly interested in. I also have to make a correction again. The idea that the policy, as Ms. Williams kept referring to it, only requires the name, I mean, that's the way it has evolved for this episode under Mr. Haygood, but it didn't even apply last year under his tenure for the air gas proposal, which I might add is somewhat hilarious. Just to give you an example, the document that is received from the county is entitled Air Gas Incentives Agreement, but the text never says air gas. So, in other words, it's sort of an open secret who it is, but the people who are being kept from knowing are the citizens of Alamance County. I think, as I say, part of my concern is the dual issue of public notice, but also access, public access to the information maintained by the county. And I think that there are a number of other issues. The portrayal is as though Alamance County is just being so much more harsh and difficult on all of these incentives agreements. That is just not the case, Madam Chairman. I'm afraid I was a glutton for punishment last night and stayed up after the Super Bowl to try to find some examples, because you had accurately portrayed the description that both Mr. Haygood and Mr. Williams have given today, that this is somehow an unusual thing that Alamance County is requiring, and that we are somehow more open and uncharacteristically so. So what I did was do just some online research. I would encourage any of you to do it, because this is only a couple of hours worth. But it's quite clear from at least these, I think it's 11 examples, that other counties are providing information, and I might add, in advance, 10 days prior, they also have the same public notice requirement, and those counties have listed all of the information that we're talking about, and indeed, again, in many cases, much more. So this is not some, you know, little Alamance County aberration in order to satisfy the Alamance News. This is a generally a good public policy practiced by many counties to provide this information to their public. Another thing that was sort of stated that's not quite accurate. The governor's office insists on making the final announcement of a selection of a company. But as you all would well know, all of the preliminaries, including not today because that company's here, but like last year, Airgas or Prescient, any of the companies that are considering, Alamance County is making an offer to entice these companies. It is not a final deal. It is not a surprise to the governor's office. Indeed, in some of the cases, there are multiple North Carolina counties that are making the proposal for the same manufacturer or industrial tenant. So the governor's office is only concerned with the end of the process. When, in fact, the company has decided, yes, we like Alamance County's bid, we're going to build our factory here, we're going to do so many jobs and so forth, yes, the governor will make a big announcement, put out a press release, he will state all the, you know, grand glorious things. Sometimes they give y'all a chance to make a little paragraph comment in there as well, but that's at the end of the process. I think the other most, like I said, misunderstood information is the idea that the municipalities somehow, that this would be at odds with them. As I say, to be honest, we have found the municipalities in general to be certainly more open than Mr. Haygood's administration, and equally open to the previous administration in terms of being able to provide information. So those are, I think, the main points that people, Mr. Haygood and Mr. Williams, have brought up that I want you to be sure to understand the difference in. And we would urge, you know, I would urge the maximum amount of time for the public to know. I very much like Mr. Sutton's illustration in terms of who's more important than whom. But whether it's a week out, the actual public hearing notice, a week, Wednesday. I do thank you for the parochial interest in having it be a Wednesday so that at least our newspaper could be on an equal footing in making the information available. But again, it's more than just to satisfy our interest or needs. The ultimate interest and need is for the people of Alamance County to get adequate notice about what is being proposed.
Do you see a trend in these as far as public versus public hearing? In other words, public notice. I see 2 weeks.
To the best of my knowledge, all of the notices complied with the same thing the county did in terms of its date, is it has to be at least 10 days.
10 days.
So technically, for instance, in a weekly paper like ours, it comes out on Thursday, an announcement on Thursday, 10 days is at least 10 days before the commissioner's meeting. And I think that's the case of many of those examples.
The first one I see is 2 weeks.
Yeah, most of them were 2 weeks.
Right.
In Orange County.
Orange County. what was there.
These are the ones that were sort of easy to find and frankly easy to print out. But in other words, I did not find a wholesale interpretation the way I have heard it described, that, you know, everybody else does it a certain way. I found two counties that had, that named, that gave all the detail, but not the name of the company. In other words, they gave the parameters, the job impact, and so forth. But in other words, none that gave nothing the way it's been described.
I think some of the things you demonstrate here are interesting. Some of these projects, at least one, I think in Forsyth County, was very large, like huge, $100 million. And so I would wonder if there might be, and there was one that's a $3,000 grant to a veterinary hospital. I would wonder if the outliers in economic development, the very, very small, but the very, very large projects, would lend themselves toward more publication of information early, and sort of the more in the middle economic development projects, there's maybe more give and take, or something that has more trade secret or competitive advantage. Like in the example we saw with Honda here today, they're looking to expand so that they can manufacture a different product at this facility. So we don't know if Honda's adding to their line or whatever that might mean, or if they have a new process, a new technology that they want to use in producing something. Those are interesting things that would be more of a, less of an outlier and being very large or very small, and more to the point of needing some kind of flexibility in how we approach it,
The situation. I found no such differentiation. I mean, I gave them to you because they're from small counties that had the small kind of project to a large county that had a large project, but lots of stuff in between, just that was available.
Right.
But I don't see any pattern such as you're describing.
Yeah.
Let me also just comment, sort of sidebar, maybe it was more appropriate at the other hearing, but with regard to the Honda situation. One of the things that we found in our news coverage for the Honda situation is that 3 years ago, I believe it would have been, fall of 14, Governor McCrory was at an event hosted by Honda celebrating their, I think it was 33rd anniversary, and announcing an $8.5 million expansion of some sort, for which, to the best of my knowledge, there was no request for incentives. So basically, in a difference of $2 million and 6 months, 3 years and 6 months, now there's a request. But in other words, they've had, if I'm not mistaken, a number of expansions, most of which did not request government funding, government subsidies or incentives, whatever description you get. But that's just a sidebar. Any questions I can address on my end?
Well, I just wanted to say, in defense of Mr. Haygood, the way I read the policy, he's following the policy. The policy says give notice, just the name of the company, and that when we do the set the public hearing, and that there's language in here that you don't give the whole detail of the package until.
Well, in practice, later. At least Mr. Honeycutt's policy practice.
Well, maybe the practice has changed, but.
But following the same, because y'all haven't changed it, I don't think, in the past year, was to provide the other information as evidenced in the earlier examples that I gave you. As you'll see.
But the reason we're having this discussion is to review the policy, though, so, but I thought it was unfair to give Mr. Haygood a little ding when he was actually following what I interpreted the policy.
Well, pardon me for giving you a ding, right. Mr. Haygood. But in other words, if he followed the policy now, he didn't follow it last year when he refused to reveal even the name of the company. So, we've had an ongoing problem. I met with him in his office last year and had a very unsatisfactory discussion about the need to comply. And this year, I just decided to take a different route because I felt like I knew how that was going to go again.
Well, hopefully you find this discussion satisfactory, if not in
more
results, at least in thoroughness.
I think I'm moving in the right direction, and I hope, like I say, whichever one point of timing, I think the issue is the people ought to know. And to take Mr. Sutton's illustration just a little bit farther, and not to mean to demean the commissioners, but I don't think it is sufficient for only the commissioners to know 3 or 4 days out, or even a week out, what the situation is. Is the agenda packet posted online?
Yes.
As soon as it's prepared and given to the commissioners?
Yes.
So, but then again, people would only know to look for it. They're just not going to be trolling the Alamance County website, I don't think, to see what's on the agenda next week. They need to know that something is coming through a public notice.
Well, there's no doubt we rely on you all to get information out to a great degree. What's the pleasure of the board? Does anybody have a motion they want to make regarding the...
Commissioner Gaines. May I say one?
No, Mr. Lawrence, I'm not going to recognize you. Does the board have the pleasure of a motion to entertain, or do we want to take this under advisement consideration?
I'm not going to vote for Mickey Mouse one day approved.
What's the least that's reasonable? Is a week reasonable?
I think the week at least gives us...
Well, so you guys can define the weekend, Saturdays and Sundays, business days, or whatever.
The press operates 7 days a week.
Yeah. So I think
the press operates 7 days a week.
You think they're willing to print something on a Saturday or a Sunday? Come on.
Well, it'll be another Saturday before a meeting, which that does.
Yeah.
I have to say that I'm struggling a little bit with the idea that the press is rigidly fixed on schedule of going to press at a certain hour on a certain day. I think with the internet, many of our press or media outlets are constantly revising, constantly putting up new content. And so I would question whether or not there's the Friday, Saturday, Sunday is in the can, but I'm not a newspaper person. I don't know, maybe that is the case.
If you stay in office, you'll learn the process.
I would make a motion, if you don't mind, that we do have this available to the public 1 week prior
seven days
to our meeting.
Second day motion.
A week in my book is 7 days.
Yeah. Seven
so that
calendar
would be
days.
A Monday? Would that be a Monday?
It would be like on a Monday, we release the details of the package to the public, and then they have a whole week to look at it.
I'll second that.
And that's not just that's by virtue of a press release?
Yes.
Versus a public notice?
I would think a public notice or press should be.
The public notice goes out.
It's going
10
out
days,
10 days prior.
Before, so.
I think a public notice has the legal requirement of being published in itself in the newspaper,
right.
Versus a press release just being
the press release
information
would be
being
asked to what's actually being asked for, what we're looking to do.
So the public notice is really to give notice of a hearing.
Yeah,
that's right.
And this would be in addition, come after the public notice,
three
it would be a
later.
Press release about the details.
3 days
after. You can live with that.
I'm going to live with whatever the county commissioners.
Well, and I think that's true. Mac will work with us.
Yeah, but I guess the real question is that that's not going to seriously compromise our ability to attract companies.
I wouldn't.
Maybe it will now and then, but.
We'll put it into practice and see how it works.
But I would have one question, Commissioner. So do you want us to, in the press release, are we to be completing negotiations at the time of the press release?
I think we need to expose to ask. Now, there may be some fine details how we get to the final product, but they're asking for $262,000 for a $10 million, those details need to be in.
I think that's the question is, do we want to make sure the companies understand that 7 days before the public hearing, we'll need to know number of jobs, total, number, final number of capital investment in real and personal property and the county's final cash incentive offer?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
About what time on that Monday? Noon?
It's helpful to nail it down as far as you want to.
I don't want to wait 5 o'clock. It takes out a day.
I would say keep it set. Monday morning, they need to have that in by 10 o'clock.
Can we say noon so that they have the morning to work on?
I think noon would be better.
Yeah.
To say noon.
Now, I'd like to, before we vote, interject this. Now, I have a problem. If it didn't bother everybody in here today and the general public that we got a major corporation in this community that employs 40% of their employees as temporaries, I despise temporaries.
Yeah, I do.
I despise it with passion. It's designed for low wages, no benefits, and the people are kept dangling out there praying that they can stay on. It's been abused in this community like crazy. And I can name the companies. But to sit back and to be told 40%, I almost felt I'm a chairman heard it. At least he's brutally honest. And I would like to know, and I appreciate it for being honest, 40%, that's stunning. That's stunning. America used not be this way. You go to work for a good company, you have a job unless you hit your boss. You might keep it then.
Okay, so we
have... Wait, I'm not through. My father worked for Burlington Industries for 40-some years, plant manager of their biggest plants in Alabama, South Carolina, so forth. I can't comprehend Burlington Industries. Now, yes, they went down the tubes, but not because they didn't use temporaries. They went down because of style. My father had a hosiery plant. Hosiery went out. Hosiery went down. I can't comprehend that Burlington would have ever had the 800 some employees that we had in South Carolina and Alabama, 40% or half the plant, half the plant temporaries, no benefits, no insurance. I mean, it's a disgrace for the American worker. I believe that. And I would like to know with every request, now I don't know if it needs to be a separate part of another motion or part of this one, that anytime we have an incentive request, that we know to what degree their employees are going to be full-time with benefits and so forth, and not temporaries. Now, I know for a fact you got companies in this town where people literally don't know whether they're going to work that day or not until they go to the plant and just sit there, and then they come in and say, yes, we need you today, or no, we don't. You go home. You done put in 3 hours, 2 hours getting there. Some people walk to the plant. It's a disgrace what we're doing temporary for in this community. And to think that we got such a high-profile company making billions of dollars worldwide that we think we got to operate with temporaries. And I don't think it's something we need to foster nor promote nor endorse without full knowledge of it. And I would like to know with every incentive request to what degree they're using temporaries. So I'll make that as a separate motion, or we incorporate it in this.
I think that would maybe be a separate motion.
Okay,
that
I'll make
be
it
part of the request. We're talking about deadlines and what we're dealing with here.
Yeah, I agree. We have a motion and a second on the floor. Is there any more discussion about the motion to have a noon on Monday deadline for the terms contemplated in economic development incentive proposal to be done, to be released to the public in a press release?
That's 7 days, right?
7 days.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and then we have a second motion from Mr. Sutton.
I'm not a big motion person, but you know, it's, if they thought that question wasn't coming today, they don't know me. I have sat up here for years and known about the temporary use of employment in this community. And if you want to pay somebody $12 an hour or $13 an hour and make them full-time, that's up to you. But to think that we're helping people in this community by fostering companies that hire and thrive off temporary labor when it's not a temporary business, or temporary market, I think it's a disgrace. But I make a motion that every incentive request that we know to what degree the company uses temporary labor.
I'll second that.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion on that?
Well, I have a little bit of a problem. I don't know whether it's our job to micromanage a company and how they run their business.
And I don't consider, forget it, I can't consider, do you think that's micromanaging? That's simply asking questions.
Well, asking the question is fine, but you're inferring that we're not going to do something if...
Well, I think that's important. This is my last time to support any company that pays, has part-time people.
So, okay, so I think we heard at our last meeting, again, a woman who came and spoke to us about asking the county to ban the box. You weren't here.
Ban the what?
Ban the box. And so it's the question that most employers have to ask whether or not somebody has been convicted of a felon.
Yeah.
And so there's a move, and I think it's a good movement, to do away with that question up front. Not that the company can't explore that if that's important, depending on what the job that they're applying for is, but at least get rid of that question. So maybe we ought to ask that question too, with the idea that, I mean, I'd be more in favor of supporting a company's request if they ban the box. But that opens up another level of questioning questions. Do we really want to get into all that, you know, how they do their business as we consider these matters?
We're giving them money, we need to know.
Well, I think what Tim is saying is that we don't have to tell them how we're going to vote or what we're going to do based on that, but we need the public knowledge of how many are going to be full-time versus a temporary.
And I agree with that, I guess, because, I mean, really, coming from the healthcare business, you know, it ends up people who don't provide health insurance because their employees might be temporary is a burden on our healthcare system.
Yeah. And we need those that has knowledge to how to look at the whole package.
Okay.
I think that's exactly true, that they kind of were paying benefits to people. I would say that I think that if the American consumer was willing to pay more for certain things, then companies might be able to offer more benefits. I think that when you have companies that are competing with one another on prices. I read an article myself about this topic with how much people who are willing to hire employees who are illegally and are willing to look the other way about immigration status are able to charge less for the same job as someone who does offer benefits or employs workers who are going to pay into Social Security and so forth. So I think it's a bit more complicated than just the percentage of workers. But I fully support having more information available to the public and knowing what we're dealing with. And I agree that if the company doesn't like it, then they don't have to ask. So Mr. Sutton has a motion on the table. Was there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, great. Is there any more discussion?
May I ask a point of clarification?
Yes, Mr. Williams.
And that would be, the way it was phrased was, if the company has, to what extent the company has temporary employees. Does that mean company-wide?
That's a great question.
Or does that mean just for the project in question? So that's the point
that's
of clarification.
Good point.
I would say just where our money is part of the deal.
We're not worried about what they have in Wisconsin or whatever else.
That's a good question, yes. So that would be the...
I just did.
Yeah.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great. Thank you very much. As far as other parts of reviewing the economic development incentive policy, we'll, I guess, table that discussion for another day since...
Thank you, Mac. Thank you for being here.
Madam Chair, we will make these changes and bring it back to the next meeting, incorporating at least what we've done here today. We will insert that language into the policy and bring it back to the next meeting for sure.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have an opioid litigation update with Mr. Albright. All right, let's have a 5-minute recess. Our meeting with the opioid Litigation update, Mr. Albrecht.
Hello. I had a conference call with the Oklahoma Association of County Commissioners on the 26th of January. We had a number of the three division firm and the court firm go over the details of the litigation. And then last Friday, I had the county attorney's conference in Chapel Hill where all the county attorneys that were present discussed this issue. The issue being, as I've looked at this, my suggestion to the county attorneys is we have a special fee arrangement so that there is a giant settlement, that we don't pay 25% of that settlement immediately. And we have some type of cap, and I've just briefly mentioned it to George, that we have some type of cap or cost and hourly fees so that the law firms that are involved and that are carrying the freight on this thing don't walk away with 25% of $1 billion settlement. That's just one of the things we discussed. We also talked about reimbursing the county attorney's office if we get tagged with a lot of discovery, because this is a federal lawsuit. It's filed in, it's ongoing now in Ohio. If there is no settlement, then the trials will be bumped back to Middle District, North Carolina, or wherever the county is located. So we'll be faced with a trial. And we'll have some significant costs to prepare our director of public health, our DSS director, for their depositions, perhaps prepare you for your depositions, these type of things. And so I wanted to cover that in the special fee arrangement that the county attorney's office could get a bit of that money to reimburse the county for doing the legal work, if that comes about. Hopefully we'll have this done within the next 5 to 10 days. Gilbert County attorney and I are working on a sample of a special fee arrangement. I've discussed it with the Kruger Dickinson firm just in broad brush. I don't have any details yet. They were amenable to that. Briefly mentioned it to George, and we'll get into details, but that's where we stand now with this litigation. It may be that the major pharmaceutical companies will get together and create a settlement pool, like a tobacco company.
That's probably likely.
But I don't know that they'll do that, but they make billions of dollars a year. They may just say, here's $1 billion, you all decide how you want to divide it up. That could happen. I don't think it's likely, but it could happen.
But this still isn't a class action suit.
No.
It still is the county bringing it individually.
Individually. And the Attorney General's office has decided that they're going to wait and decide. Our Attorney General went and met with 40 other Attorney Generals at the latest meeting up there in Ohio. One of the problems that we're going to face is proving how the person has been injured or proving our damages. For instance, we had a case where a prisoner in the jail fell down and hurt his knee. He had surgery at Chapel Hill. His knee became infected. We sent him to the hospital, and all he wanted was more opioids. They addressed his injuries. He was sent to the state prison, where he re-injured himself and was put on more opioids down there, and later had his leg amputated because he contracted MRSA. I give that as just an example as to how these things will twist and turn. So we're going to have to give our damages on that particular case, because I ended up going to court to get that case dismissed because he sued the sheriff in that case. That's a fee that we had to be faced with. But I can't tell you how we're going to handle that in these death claims when a person has died over the last 10 years and the body has been cremated because they were a drug addict and didn't have any family. I can't tell you how to prove that. So there are problems of proof, as there are in any lawsuit. But I just see this one as very time-consuming because we're going to be asked to show that if you're going to ask a company to pay for it.
What about the theory of the case of being a public nuisance, where the board would declare the opioid crisis, I believe, to be a public nuisance? Can you inform the board about what that means?
Yeah, we talked about that at the attorney's conference, and I think the consensus is that's probably not a good idea, because you're going to have to show some type of direct connection to the cost to the county directly related to treatment of someone that's got opioid problems.
So we feel like the best approach is to handle it through perhaps false advertising, misleading advertising on behalf of drug manufacturer and the distributors. There's a recent report in West Virginia, a town of 2,900 people. There are two pharmacies in that particular area that have distributed 20.8 million hydrocodone pills in the last 10 years in a town of 2,900. That's an easier argument to make. And the case being, in that case, they said they were non-addictive, not habit. Apparently they are. So that's the way the consensus ruled out, because when you declare a nuisance, you have to be able to show, you have to have some testimony from your health director that shows that connection. And we rely on the state of North Carolina to provide that information for us. We don't have, they're so busy treating people, they don't have time to write down an entire questionnaire about the person who's walked in that has an addiction problem. We can't go back and see where it started. That's kind of information that I would be interested in developing. So, to prove a nuisance, you have to show that.
And we, I think we had earlier voted to send out a request for proposals or
yes.
Requests for contracts from law firms.
Right.
And what kind of perception did you get from
Well, the three big ones are Krueger Dixon, which I heard from, and of course, the Fuller firm, which had been here in the earlier meeting. I didn't hear a thing from Barron Budd, which is the third big player.
Barron and Budd is the same as Fuller firm.
Oh, is the same?
They
have
six national law firms together.
Okay.
Right. And that's the firm that I think a lot of the other
right.
counties that have engaged.
That's the one I've seen. Yeah.
Right. Outside council have hired that firm.
The reason I want to do a special fee arrangement is to address the problems that we're going to be faced. I haven't been the recipient of, in another life, when I worked for corporations. When you get involved with lawsuits like this, you're going to be flooded with discovery, and I mean flooded. So I want to have somebody on the ground that's able to assist in answering those questions. So that's the report.
What are other counties doing in that respect? Maybe we can address that.
Well, some of them have already hired either the Budd firm or Krueger Dixon or Fuller. Maybe 20. 25 maybe at this point. I've already signed up.
Yeah, but, Mr. Daniel would come forward. He's been waiting all morning for this item.
He was at our last meeting.
Yeah, hey, I saw him on video, but I hadn't seen it's been 20 years since I faced you, right?
Well, once y'all sent me home, Tim, I'd say I'm doing a baby angel thing as well.
How you doing?
Hey, Mr. Commissioner, how you doing?
Call me Tim, please.
Let me say, since I saw you all last time, Clyde's right, that to be competitive with the National Group, I think Krueger Dixon, who's tied in with the New York firm
Hanley,
they're working together. And so really it's two main, and then the group that I'm working with are Barron Budd, Popentino, Barron Budd out of Dallas, Texas, Popentino out of Florida. You have three that are out of West Virginia, and McHugh Fuller is out of Hattiesburg, Mississippi. So six major law firms and national law firms, and they have the way this multi-district litigation works is that they have a hierarchy group that oversees that, and the national group that are working with Judge Upholster up there, they have out of these committee spots, I think there are 22. This national law consortium has five of the 22, the most number of all of them. I will bore you with all that, but out of the 200 complaints that have been filed nationwide, 140 of them have been filed by this national consortium they're working with. They have the most counties in North Carolina, and I want to share with you that when I was here before, I know we talked about, I think maybe Brunswick, New Hanover, Buncombe, there may have been a couple of others, but since that time, the ones that have either, it's a two-step process. You first pass the authorization declaring the opioids coming into the county a public nuisance. Let me just stop there. That's not the only thing they sue on. That's in addition to the other issues that the New York firm, the only ones that are including in public nuisance is the group that I'm working with, in addition. And they not only are suing the wholesale distributors, but they're suing the manufacturers as well.
Let me interrupt. There's alternate theories of the case. You don't just have that one.
Yeah, ultimate. And the thing is, don't leave that in. If you go into the store, load them all up.
Well, the complaint is 565 paragraphs, 178 pages long.
Well, I mean, the kind of money you're talking about, you know, and I honestly think that, you know, if it is a settlement, it should be in excess of that for most of it, but be that what I know. So, but let me explain to you that Bladen County has already, they passed a resolution on December the 18th, I understand, and they went with, I'm going to call it Baron and Bud, it's too full of Baron and Bud. They've gone with them. Buncombe County's already filed a lawsuit, Baron and Bud. I'm going to just name the ones that are Baron and Bud right there. Burke County, and since I've seen you, I understand that a Baron and Bud group public nuisance resolution was adopted there early on. They haven't actually signed the contract to file the lawsuits yet. Catawba County, Baron and Bud. Chatham County passed a public nuisance resolution on November the 20th. Haven't yet filed the lawsuits yet. Gaston County, just last week, I understand, went with Baron and Bud. They filed a and they have retained them on January the 12th and filed a lawsuit last week. As I mentioned, Onslow County previously had signed with Baron and Bud. Person County, Ron Acock there. Since I've seen y'all, since January 16th, have come on board, not filed a lawsuit yet, but adopted the resolution and retained Baron and Bud. Orange County. On the 23rd, presented that night, they went into closed session and passed a resolution and signed on with the group I'm working with. Pitt County has, as of January the 18th, passed a resolution and retained Baron and Bud. Randolph County, they've authorized Baron and Bud to file a lawsuit on January the 2nd. Rockingham County, December the 12th, they filed that lawsuit with Baron and Bud. Rutherford County, lawsuit was filed on December the 15th, Baron and Bud Group. Surrey County, December the 15th, Baron and Bud Law Group. Wilkes County, I don't know that they've signed, they filed it yet, but they engaged Baron and Bud on January the 19th. And Yadkin County, December the 17th, Baron and Bud Law Group with them. And the other smaller counties, I do know that Columbus County is considering something today. Franklin County, I think next week. That's about the best I can do from my memory. But that gives you some indication. I told Clyde that whenever he has something to look at, I'll be happy to present to the group. I know that, and I understood that Guilford, as of last week, I was told, I don't know the public yet, that they were coming on with Baron and Bud. Any questions?
The main thing is that before we pass some submissions, and I want this board to hear from Susan Osborne, because she doesn't have her information ready yet. Last time I spoke to Susan,
I am curious about the progression of this from the other side. You should know how I feel about the drug, Big Pharma, and what it did for, I want to at least say it, ADHD, yeah. And then over into this arena here. Is this U.S. Supreme Court? Would this be on the path to go to the Supreme Court if they didn't settle, or how would that
federal play? Court.
State court.
It's in federal court.
It's in a federal court.
Right. You can file in federal court.
Right.
And go with this group to this multi-district litigation in
right.
Ohio.
Right.
But if it doesn't settle,
yeah,
then the case will get kicked back to wherever you happen to be in the district court system. You will have a trial. And you can appeal to the Fourth Circuit, in our case, and then to the Supreme Court if there's an issue for appeal.
Okay. Commissioner Sutton, the reason is of how the multi-district litigation all across the country, all these states, all these many counties, there's one judge that's going to deal with pretrial motions and deal with all the discovery issues. If they don't settle, Clyde's right. They're going to say, okay. But he's going to have dealt with discovery and motions. he does all that. Then it comes back to the local jurisdiction to be tried in the local federal court.
I just want to make sure that it's clear for the public that we're not talking about, you know, penalizing people who are in pain or getting pills out of people who, you know, away from people who are in pain and have legitimate medical needs. That this opioid litigation has to do with these pharmaceutical manufacturers, and then those who were given the power by the federal government to distribute these pills, that the theory of the case is that they abused their power, that they abused their opportunity, and that they flooded our county with these pills, and then people in good faith took them, and then it had a terrible effect on their well-being and on the well-being of our community. And so how do we hold those pharmaceutical companies and those distributors responsible for the damages that they've done in our community? And to, we're trying to look out for the individual citizen who's been so harmed by it. So I just want to be sure that that's well communicated to the public, because I think there is some anxiety from people to hear about, you know, opioids and litigation, that those with legitimate pain needs are going to be prevented from getting help from this instance. Now, there may be state level or federal level initiatives that they should be more concerned about, but as far as individual people being concerned about getting pills from their doctor for legitimate pain needs, this would not be something that they should be concerned about.
I think the state had already passed.
They addressed that at the end of the year.
They've limited the number that you get. You got to go back to the doctor.
Yeah.
But please know that this lawsuit is, at least from the consortium, six law firms that we're working with, they're not limiting to just wholesale distributors. The one reason they included the wholesale distributors is because if you know the revenue, they make the most money. America Source Bertram in 2017 at $153,144,000,000 annually. Cardinal Health, $135 billion annually. McKesson Corporation. Cardinal is up in Ohio where Judge Polster is, that they are holding. That's where he is addressing all of these orders. McKesson Corporation, $198,533,000,000 for a grand total of $486,677,000,000 annually.
That's just in 1 year.
Revenue. And the manufacturers that would be, you think the manufacturers would be the ones that are rich. Purdue Pharma, $3 billion, estimated in 2015. Teva Pharmaceutical Industries, $84,080,000,000 2016. Johnson and Johnson and its makeup, $71,937,000,000 2016. Endo Health Solutions, $4 billion 2016. Allergan PLC, $14,571,000,000, and then Mallicrop, $381,000,000. And the manufacturer's gross revenue, the collective total, $180,979,000,000. So you see where the biggest amount of money is, but they're not being discriminated against. And where you're going to sue the wholesale distributors and not sue the manufacturers, they are included, as well as all issues are included. The only difference with our group is that we are including that additional public nuisance, because it is done so well, as I understand, and it is related to me in West Virginia. That's how they were able to get that ARCOS data, and so county by county, they've included that in the 140 counties of the 200 county lawsuits they filed.
I think it's important to make the connection between the billions and billions of dollars going into those corporations' pockets and the children that we have in foster care in Alamance County, because their parents are too strung out on drugs to be able to take care of them because of some kind of, they're flooding the market with these opiates and the other public health implications.
That's a good point. That's why we need that data. before you folks pass a resolution declaring nuisance. And my goal, and I haven't been shy about it, I want to maximize any settlement, maximize Alamance County share of it. And even though I'm a lawyer and believe in attorney's fees, I'm beating up on this guy.
Well, not right.
But with this special fee arrangement, to see if we can work something out that's a little more satisfactory to the citizen.
I just want to, I want to bring this information to you so you can make your decision. Whatever local council that I would have to do, again, I'm not sophisticated as one of these lawyers in this six large national law firm, but I do have responsibilities, and their responsibilities would be to be here for you and to do what I need to do. I need to do on the ground. Every Caswell and Durham and the counties that I'm involved with. Pretty much, I put my name and reputation on the line too. And so, as far as how it ends up working out, the as I told you before, I think the local, they had a 25%, it was 30% before, but they dropped that down to 25%. I know that these other counties have come on board, all of theirs are changing 25%. Ultimately, I would assume that the judge is going to have the final say as to what the attorney's fees are. But it starts with having a free contract. So the local council is explaining what our involvement would be. And I want to thank all of y'all for giving me another opportunity to come up here and speak with you.
Thank you. Does anybody else have any questions?
How soon will you have what you need back to us?
I'm working on it. Today, my assistant's working on it, finalizing it, what we discussed at our meeting on Friday.
So potentially and look at a resolution.
I'm thinking the next couple of days we'll have something that I can send to George and let him take a look at it, and then we can bring it to you.
They had a meeting, as I understand, with Judge Holster on January the 31st. And the only thing is, I certainly don't want us to, and like I said, there are only about 20 of the 100 counties that have thought. I know they're a lot in work. We'll probably see a lot more of them sign on. We believe they'll be signing on with Barron and Bud, but they may be with some others in the next few weeks. And don't want to get left out.
Great. Thank you so much for that update. All right, budget amendments. The first one, the performance management employee bonus.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Commissioners. For you at this time, to request board action to approve paying all eligible employees a one-time $500 performance management bonus for fiscal year 16-17. Fiscal year 16-17 audit has been completed, and the performance management report is also posted online via the county's website. You also have it in your packets. So you can peruse it at your leisure. I'm pleased to report that all county departments successfully completed at least 75% of their performance management goals in fiscal year 17, which is the requirement to be able to qualify for a performance management bonus. The total cost of these proposed PM bonuses of $500 per employee comes to $451,509.55. This amount would be taken from the department's bank PM savings. You must understand this is different than how we have done this every year before. 16-17, we do revenues over expenditures in the audit to determine how much savings the county bank overall in the big picture. The county only banked $137,391.20 after doing the revenue over expenditure calculation. We also had to take out $1.5 million for a school system capital reserve. Those funds were actually came in through the school system sales tax articles, so we had to take that off. So we really, revenue over expenditure was $1.6 million. We had to take $1.5 out of that. Well, that did not leave enough dollars in revenue over expenditure savings to give employee bonuses from the performance management program. The reason I'm asking, I talked with the department heads, they have enough money in their bank savings. The departments can carry forward bank savings year to year. They currently have $1,342,311.29 in bank PM savings. But because this is a deviation from the policy, normally we take the employee bonus dollar amount off the top of our revenues over expenditure savings. As there was not enough money to do that, I'm asking that the board allow the saving, the bonus of $500 would be paid from the department's bank safe. The reason I am asking, because this has actually become an effective management tool, the PM program, we use this bonus as an incentive to encourage departments to accomplish specific goals. So we give them goals, especially now as we're moving toward adoption of our strategic plan. That is our way we want to implement the strategic plan, is put specific goals in departments, PM goals, and they'll work on them. And well, they did that, but the money isn't there in the revenue over expenditure, but it is there in their bank savings. So I've talked with them. All the department heads are amenable to this if the board will approve it, but it does take board approval for this to happen. So again, the request that I have is to take $451,509.55 from department's bank PM gold, bank PM savings, to pay eligible employees a one-time bonus of $500 based on their department's performance from fiscal year 16-17. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
How many people are projecting here?
Total number of employees that are eligible, I'm not sure off the top of my head. I know finance has run those numbers because they have to have been employed by January 15th of that fiscal year, so they had some part in contributing toward the department achieving its goal. So it's 451.
But it looks like, according to the spreadsheet, Commissioner Sutton, that would be 775 employees.
For everybody. Yeah. The vast majority of them, yes. 775?
Yes, sir.
So, Brian, with respect to that ratio I keep asking about, the level of the fund balance as a percentage of our annual operating expenses that we're targeting to have at 25%, does this reduce that?
Well, on one hand, it does not. We have currently $26.3 million, which is 18.3% of FY 16-17. So our unassigned, I call it free and clear.
Yes.
The way I have to think of it to keep it straight. Our free and clear fund balance is $26.3 million, 18.3%. The board's goal is to get that to 25%.
Right.
These funds are designated, so it will not come out of that $26.3 million.
Right.
But you do need to understand, when we spend it, the expenditure goes up, so our percentage will go down. If we're not actually spending our free and clear fund balance, but because if we make this expenditure, the percentage may go down. It may go up, that, you know, we won't know until the 17-18.
There's a lot of moving parts.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, that answers my question.
I just got a curious math question. It says we're going to pay out $451,000. It's $500 per. I'm not real good at math, but I think that's a few more people in the 17.
That figure also includes the benefits for that, which would be the FICA.
Okay.
That we would need to pay on that as well. Plus, too, some of that is prorated for our part-time employees. They add to the department meeting their goals, so they would receive a prorated bonus based upon their percentage of employment.
But the total dollar amount is $451,500.
So is that 775 employees, including part-timers? Or
yes.
Full-time equivalent?
Yes.
So it's basically
full-time equivalent.
So. Full-time equivalent, so that's different.
Yes. Full-time equivalent is 778.725.
Anybody have a motion?
I will let
you
do that.
I'll second that.
I'd like to say something about that. You know, Brian and I, we're the ones who went down to Davidson County to talk about what became performance management. And we brought it back. No, it wasn't you, it was Tim Burgess. Excuse me. Sorry to confuse you with him anyway. And we brought it back and implemented it. And of course, I was gone for 2 years, but I hear we've had success with it. With much reservation, I want to vote for this, but I don't think this was totally concept of what I think of as performance management, and
I have to agree with you, too.
Yeah, as well as what the county I thought was looking at, and or how it's to be perceived.
I would say that you know, the elements in this program are savings and goal accomplishment,
right?
And you know, the idea is can the departments accomplish at least 3/4 of their goals that they state for the year and at the same time save money? And do those for less than they projected in their budget. I think two things have happened. One, this has been a dynamic policy. We've made changes to this over the years. I think our first year with this might have been 11-12 or 10-11. I can't remember. It's been a number of years. We've made several changes to it as we've been through it. I would tell the board it's time to revisit it. And we went, I think this may be the first or second year that we went to a pool model where departments don't necessarily get to retain their actual savings. It all goes into a pool, and that is a good model. There's some good points to it. It's much easier for us to be clear about the savings because it's audit-based. But I think it does incentivize some of our larger departments to spend because they don't get to keep their actual savings. We've done that for at least a year, maybe two. I think it would be time for us to revisit going back to that. That way, if a department, the original idea was the department saves enough for these bonuses for its own employees. It may not be across the board. It might be just one department gets it because they got their goals and they save the money.
Well, I thought that's how we set it up.
It was originally, and it changed again. I don't remember. This may be the second year that it's been like this. I would suggest that we consider returning to that. It is too late for 16-17, and again, it has become, one, a way for us to encourage departments to not spend as much as they might normally in hopes that they get to keep it, and really in hopes they get to do these bonuses, because that's very important to each department, that they at least save enough at the end of the year that they can give a bonus. But it also is a great management tool because we tie these goals to it. And we say, if you accomplish these things and save these funds, you get to give a bonus. And again, I know all our departments would agree, our people are our most important resource. They want to reward them. And this has a level of accountability as well as reward. I do think the pooling model needs to be addressed. I think it would get us back closer to what you're talking about, Mr. Sutton, the original idea of the program. But again, for 16-17, we operated under the pool. I would recommend making this approval for this time, but then we need to revisit the policy and revise it.
Awesome. Well, we have a motion and a second. Is there further discussion?
Before we vote here, you know, again, in theory, though, this case would go, you know, 1 or 2 years. I mean, once you get to a certain plateau or plane of savings or efficiency, you know, it's expected to be part of your normal job duties. And I don't see where you could even theorize that you give a bonus every year to this many people.
How long has it been? 7 years?
I don't know. Burgess and I went down there.
See, that's my problem with this thing. I think it's gone too far. It's too long.
I mean, I believe it's got savings avenues here and good incentives. But I'd love to see a lot of numbers on next fiscal year as far as how we're going to implement it. What kind of savings are these departments having versus the number of employees in there is getting, well, for instance, a potential $500 bonus.
So,
I mean, you know, you say $50,000, but you're going to give up in one department, whatever the numbers come out to be. You know, I'm voting blind here, you know, technically. I feel like, you know, I don't like voting, but I'm going to support it. This issue, we really got to look at it.
I agree.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Is everyone ready to vote? All right, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, budget amendment for the health department.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
All right, so what you have before you is a budget amendment from the office, or to the health department from the Office of Rural Health. We were awarded $20,600 to be used for what they call Community Health Medical Access Plan. This program helps us serve the uninsured and underserved populations that we see at the health department. Primarily, we're using this for maternity health, so our prenatal clinic. I'm requesting these funds be added to our budget.
And I noticed there are no local funds required.
There are no local funds required, no match.
I had a question. Does that mean you'll be actually serving more people?
So theoretically, we could be serving more people. Why we went to this particular grant was that we also saw at the General Assembly last session that we had a reduction in the maternal child health block grant that was going to go statewide. that would also mean a reduction in our funds locally. And so we wanted to look at alternative ways to also serve our patients. And so we looked for grants that would also help us serve the underserved population that we have, knowing that our general fund decided to cut that block grant to the tune of 39%. So we got creative.
I will make a motion that we accept this.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you so much. All right, budget amendment from Soil and Water Conservation.
Good morning, Commissioners. I'm pleased to be before you today and to ask you to accept a $5,000 grant that we have received from Carolina Farm Credit. If you recall, last year I came before you and asked for permission to go after a Golden Leaf grant, which we did receive, that allowed us to purchase a no-till grill. We're very fortunate that our local Farm Bureau assisted in that as well. And then here a little bit later, we did receive some assistance from Carolina Farm Credit to be used for the drill, and to also purchase a shed that would help protect the drill for future long-term use. And I come before you today to ask you to accept this grant.
You may have any questions?
Well, not being a farmer, can you explain what that is?
So you're familiar with plowed ground, what a plow does, it inverts the soil, it leaves it bare and so forth, which leaves it exposed for erosion, whether it be wind or rain, of course. And those deposits, number one, flooded in North Carolina 7. That's why the Hall River changes colors after hard rain events. The no-till aspect, this piece of equipment, if you're going to plant any of your small grains, wheat, barley, oats, soybeans, things of that nature, not so much corn. It allows you to use a cover crop. You can kill your cover crop with a herbicide. Use this drill to go in and plant into what's currently there. There's no plowing, there's no bare soil. So your soil stays cooler, which saves water through evaporation. It also helps tremendously with runoff, which runoff can be almost zero.
Use a lot for pasture and hay.
Very much so. The intended use of this grant that we received from the Golden Leaf Foundation was to assist with the pastures, particularly through some of the droughts in recent times, other parts of the state that flooding and so forth. We were fortunate enough to receive one, but to go into a pasture and improve existing sod. This piece of equipment is pretty expensive, so a lot of your smaller farmers will never own one. However, through this program and the drill, working with the county, they'll be able to rent it from the county to use on their farm.
Who takes liability of that once it leaves our premises, basically?
When they hook to it with their truck, working with Clyde and his team, it basically is the responsibility of the person who's the renter.
I'll make the motion we accept that.
Second.
Any further discussion?
More than more than that, right?
No, it makes sense.
I don't understand why it's called what it's called.
Yeah. All right, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you so much.
Thank you.
County Manager's Report.
One thing I wanted to pass to the board today was just to give you a couple of important dates. We prepared a budget calendar. We'll be giving that out to all of you very, very soon. Budget for fiscal year 2018-19. Finance will be sending out budget prep packets to departments, fire departments, and outside agencies today. These packets will be due back the 1st of March. For us to start processing and going through, currently we're looking at our budget retreat taking place on April 2nd, and then we're looking at May 7th being the proposed date for the manager's recommended budget presentation, and then May 21st the public hearing on the proposed budget, and then that would give the board two dates, June 4th or June 18th, to adopt the budget. So We'll be getting this information to you very soon, but just wanted you to go ahead and be thinking along those lines. And that's all I have.
When do we have to make decisions about the bond referendum?
The Alamance Community College and ABSS will be coming on March 19th. They'll be coming to present their resolutions and their lists of projects and the costs. And I'll also be giving the board data about what we see that would equate out in cost. How would we pay for these things? The idea would be if the board finds their proposals acceptable, you would vote that night, March 19th. And that starts the ball rolling for us to be able to get the information on the November 2018 ballot. So they're coming March 19th. That would be the kickoff day. There are some other points along the way where the board would have opportunity to stop the process. There's a public hearing that has to happen. I believe that's sometime in April. So there's some other points, but March 19th is really kind of the kickoff for all of us.
When is the deadline to get that referendum on the
ballot? Let's see. We worked pretty closely with Kathy Holland over at the Board of Elections and our bond attorney and Aunt Clive and Susan. A lot of people worked. Really, the 19th would be ideal if the board will adopt their resolutions on the 19th. Then we have a lot of background work to do between the 19th and April 2nd. April 2nd is when, I believe that's when you're asking for the public hearing to be set. I think that's right. And then April 16th would be when you have the public hearing. That's when folks come and you have to adopt the bond orders at that time. So really, those dates, the 2nd only because if you don't want to set the public hearing, that would stop the process. But if we stick to this bond calendar, we feel pretty certain that we can have it on the ballot in plenty of time because I know the Board of Elections has to prepare absentee ballots. They have a lot of background work to do, too. So it would be great if we could stay on this. And I think we should reshare this with the board if you need us to send it to you again.
Well, to me, this is a lot like an incentives request. Again, you're bringing everything to us with it being in our face to vote that night. I mean, it's human nature that this process flows in. And I would like to have a guaranteed buffer in there of if we want to restructure, cut, not support, whatever. I mean, it's putting a lot on us, in my opinion, to expect us to consume all of this on one night. Especially if you expect to vote from us. And I'd like to be able to have a buffer in there where I could say, okay, I hear you. And then us go back and say, possibly, we don't agree with the dollars. We don't agree with the finance.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
I've got a problem with what I'm hearing and reading. There's no way I can support this type of bond referendum. No way.
Expect too much at one night.
Or being asked to give up too much. And the cost is to build on the three different schools, three different high schools, and at the same time build a new high school, it doesn't make sense. It's just ridiculous.
I'm school board is needed. Don't we get the information
together and make some cuts?
Yes, we have in fact received ACC's resolution. I'll be sending a copy of that to the board very shortly. I don't believe we have received the ABSS actual resolution yet.
But we'll have a month before that public hearing to decide
yes.
What the requests are.
Yes, that's correct.
And I'm still confused. The first date that you're talking about is what?
March 19th.
Okay, and what are we supposed to have before March 19th?
You'll have the resolution that lists out all the projects from both ABSS and ACC before then that you can review and take a look at and ask questions. We have ACC's at this time. I need to get it to all of you, but we have not received Alamance Berman School Systems yet. As soon as we receive it, we'll pass it on to the board.
And then there's another meeting.
You have something else?
No, it's the same thing that you have, Brian. So at the March 19th meeting, it's basically for the board to receive the information from ACC as well as ABS. As the resolution that you would be approving that night would allow
Brian and myself to just file a application with the LGC, which lets the LGC know we have this cut. It's not that we're approving it at this amount or anything like that. You would have a preliminary findings to make, but that's basically just stating that there is a need for it. And then at the April 2nd meeting, that's when there would be the first reading for the public hearing. But there are things, like Brian was saying earlier, that we have to do in the background. We have to prepare our statement of debt, which shows the LGC, this is what we have as debt-wise, this is our capacity, this is how we right now are planning to pay for this back, as well as filing things with the county clerk's office. It's following all the procedures that the LGC lays out for us, as well as working with our bond attorney. Then at the April 18th meeting, which we would have a public hearing, and then at that point in time when we have the meeting on the 16th, that would be for the board to finalize what dollar amount that you would want to see on the ballot at that point in time. You're not locked into a figure until that date.
So what's the date?
That would be April 16th.
That's like a month of working through that.
As long as we got some ability to put our irons in the fire, mm-hmm. the fire we want to put it in,
yes, sir.
And the irons we want to put in, then I'd support it. You know, I was sitting here thinking, you know, I'm making a commitment up or down for it on 19 March,
yes, sir.
Which I just can't support.
It's just to get the preliminary things that we need to do as staff to get it ready for the LGC, get it ready for the ballot, so that then once November comes, we have all the proper paperwork to file all the final reports with the LGC.
Thank you so much. Those were good questions, Mr. Sutton, and I share your concerns. One thing, I think Mr. Bird and I have the privilege of attending the school board's work sessions and their monthly meetings, so the evening meetings. So we have the advantage of getting to listen to their deliberations and sort of be a little more in touch with it. So I appreciate your perspective, especially.
You know, I'd like to suggest that I was part of this, where we created this vision for our school system. And then out of that, the school board adopted six major strategies on how to achieve that vision. And I think we should all be familiar with those. And because maybe you don't agree with some of those strategies, maybe you don't agree with the vision itself. But all of this is really to accomplish this bond issue, and facilities is one of those six strategies. Having a national model of a public education system, which personally I think is very important to all of us. Not the fact that it's a national model, but it's effectively educating our kids, all kids. But I just think that rather than just view this bond issue in kind of this vacuum, and well, the school system's asking all of this money for all these facilities, to really understand where we're trying to head with achieving that vision and accomplishing those six strategies to do so, and how all this kind of fits together.
Well, even more so, we have the North Carolina General Statutes that tell us that the county commissioners have the responsibility of furnishing facilities for the public school system. So.
Well, and I'll say this, you know, I mentioned this meeting I went to the Commissioners Association last week. It was the Joint Public Education Steering Committee, and the Board of Education Chairwoman Allison Gann went with me, and as well as the Tax and Finance Committee. But so this room was full at the North Hilton Hotel, full of commissioners from across the state, school board members, and superintendents. And one of the superintendents was pretty adamant, quoting a lot from the Constitution. I mean, there's a constitutional duty with respect to public education, and then there's the statutory requirements too. A lot of the discussion was around that HB 13 that reduces the class size from K through 3. But a lot of the discussion too was around what the state is proposing to put on the ballot statewide for a bond issue for school construction.
Do you know in that, is it true that if that state bond passed, we would get $24 million? Is that not the chart?
The staff at the association told me that it would be
I thought they said 25 point something million.
I'm crushing that.
The school board told me, they're under the impression it would be like $10 million, so I'm not sure what.
See, I pulled up the law, and, and I'm curious about if it's going to be on the ballot. I think you got a way off, and I'm not saying just because I want to be able to review this, that I'm against it.
I know. Or
trying to give you a dollar figure, but I am saying that we got to take into consideration, in my opinion, lottery money, possibility to get $24 million from the state, bond. I mean, there's all kind of numbers here that can come together, which, if not viewed at in its totality, you can wind up with excess like crazy, possibly, in certain arenas. And I think it just bodes well for us if we analyze every potential angle out here of the money flow.
And we need to have that knowledge.
But the chart that I gave you, sent to you, showed us getting about $24 million if it got on the ballot.
That's roughly the same.
And then you got the issue of the state bond, local bond, and how many bonds everybody going to vote for.
That's right. So that's the problem I have.
Yeah. Just to expand on a comment I just made about constitutionally and statutorily, we're charged with public education just like the school board is charged. We just all have different roles, and I like to think of us, with that charge, we all need to be on the same team. Now, we have different roles, so we have different accountabilities, and we have to hold each other accountable. Another big discussion was whether or not school boards can sue county commissioners for not funding them to the extent that they feel like is needed. So that was a big issue for the commissioners as well. But if we just think of ourselves, if we all agree that we really want our kids to be well educated, and we might disagree on some of the strategies or the funding amounts, that's fine, but we just ought to think in terms, I believe, with that ultimate objective in mind, and here we are trying to be a team, both us and the Board of Education, and figuring out how we're going to get there.
Well, I don't think it's my responsibility to vote for the taxpayers to be increased in their, but they're going to pay in property taxes for a school that is incompetent to keep throwing money, good money up the bag. This just makes no sense. And I think the taxpayers, I've talked to everybody I've talked to, I asked them, are you going to vote to support the schools in the bond referendum? And I've had two people in the last 6 months, or 2 months, to say yes. I'm telling you, if the schools think they can close Cummings and Southern High School, Graham High School, they're mistaken. The people ain't gonna buy that. They're not gonna build new schools and set the others to be used as a recreation in parks or whatever. The people aren't stupid. They're a lot smarter than we think they are.
Well, I have something that I wanted to report to the board. I've been working and talking with people about CPOM for a while, and there's problems with keeping CPOM staffed. It's a very difficult job, and there's a lot of burnout and turnover in Alamance County CPOM department, which I understand is common throughout the state, that other counties have a real problem recruiting, training, and retaining people to work in CPOM because it's very quick, fast-paced, unpredictable, and it's just a difficult job. And I understand that it requires a high school diploma but no education beyond that. And so I had an interaction with our school system, and through that, Robin Bowers has been in touch, I believe, with Dexter Brower, who's in charge of CPOM. And the Graham High School has the Fire Academy, Public Services Academy, and they're going to add a module with telecommunications in that. And I believe there's going to be a training board there where the high school students can be exposed to this career path and be trained in that. So ultimately, the vision is that we would create a pipeline of qualified and dedicated applicants for the CPOM positions, so that maybe they're younger, maybe they're not going to be there for 10, 15 years, but if they would be there for maybe a couple or 4 years while they're working on getting a degree from the community college and something else that they're interested in, they can pay their bills, they can get some valuable work experience to take with them to the next phase in life, and then somebody else comes in
who's ready and prepared to take that job when they move on to the next thing. So I just wanted the citizens to know that we take public safety very seriously, and we've been looking for ways to integrate the county's needs in retaining and training good employees with the school system's availability and interest in the public services academy. So I just wanted y'all to be aware of that.
That's what they're trying to do. That's what we're still before. Yeah.
You know, Nathan, saying that, I want to know how many firemen we hire in this hell, the whole county, and how many we've replaced once a year, how many retires. You're gonna shut down a whole school to raise people to be, or to train people to be firemen. Okay. That is about as stupid.
Well, there'd be a lot of different career academies.
That's a good example.
Madam Chair, if I can go back to a question to the previous issue on the date, I'm still not clear. I understand the dates laid out that staff is recommending, but I'm still not clear on why you would have something passed by the board prior to the public hearing to hear from the public. Can, though it was laid out in advance, could the county not wait to do those preliminary steps until the public hearing is held and the commissioners decide decisively that they want to have a bond referendum? In essence, doing it ahead of time, if there is no bond referendum, makes it all moot.
Mr. Boney, my understanding is that those are things that the bond attorney has told staff to do, that they've been in communication with the bond attorney, who has laid out this framework as how, in order to have the bonds ready for the market, and haven't had them, I guess, adequately vetted, for lack of a better term. That's what they're saying needs to be done.
And at this point, is it your understanding these would be two different bonds, ACC and ABSS?
I've not heard anything contrary to that. It's going to be two separate bonds.
Especially since one is ready and the other isn't yet.
I haven't heard anything contrary that that's okay. Going to be two separate bond issues on the ballot from the county. All right, is there anything else? Then we are adjourned. Thank you.